Hey everyone, and welcome once again inside the Lion's Den. I'm your host, Bill Lyons, and you are tuned in to another episode of The Nerd Herd. Man, I am so fucking jazzed for today's show. I've been jazzed for a week. As soon as I saw this movie, I wanted to do this podcast, and today I'm very thankful, joined by my buddy, John Iricola. And John, you haven't graced us in a while, right?
Yeah, that's very true. I have not been here in a minute.
It's been like the MCU podcast was the last one, right?
Maybe. I think that was the one. I think I was here for the MCU what, review or?
Yeah, it was the Marvel Cinematic Universe roundtable, and Endgame hadn't even come out yet.
Wow.
So
years.
Yeah. So for those of you that haven't heard that, make sure to go to linesdenmedia.com. Check it out. Follow our YouTube. It's a real, real fun show. That was a real fun show. I still go back and listen to that show.
It's a good time. I think it was the other guy that was on it. Dave was on that bad boy, and he's the one who encouraged me. Go back, re-listen to it. And you're right. We don't stop laughing.
No.
For like 40 minutes. It's great.
No, and there's so much to talk about. Like,
oh boy.
This movie, Spider-Man No Way Home, was an event.
Yeah.
It was a marvelous event.
Oh, well, look at this guy.
And I really wanted to give this podcast the same kind of gravitas and scope. So we are talking everything from fucking Toby to Tom, man. We're gonna really deep dive into everything. I'm super excited. Let's jump right in because it's gonna be a whopper of a show, man.
It's one of these things you walk out and you instantly start looking for somebody to talk to about it, and you can barely talk about anything without giving something away. I found it really hard to like go home, tell my girlfriend, like, you're not going to believe what happened. And then I have to stop. It's like, I can't tell you anything that happens in this movie. You can sit there and say Spider-Man punches things, you know. Like, that's fun, I guess.
Yeah, even like Kevin Smith was having a real, like, he spoiled it for half the audience when he did his Hollywood Babylon show.
Oh, no.
They even did a consensus. They were like, who's seen it? Who hasn't seen it? And half the audience was like, woo, we haven't seen it. And he's like, all right, so fucking when Tobey Maguire shows up. And everyone's like, what the?
Oh my God.
And poor Ralph Garman, man. He was just kind of like, dude.
Dude. Man. It's, there's just so much. There is so much that happens in this movie. Matter of fact, before we get into it, do you just want to cover No Way Home really quick and hit on the cons and the pros? Because we can do the cons like this. The cons could be...
Yeah, you know, let's talk about the cons real quick.
Okay.
We'll get that out of the way. And then I want to... We'll dial the clock back to, like, you know, 2001 Spidey.
Yeah, okay. Because, I mean, my only con that, like, fresh out of the movie, the only thing in the top of my head I wanted to see... And again, I guess, what is it... subjective or objective, it's something I personally just wanted to see in the movie and I didn't see it. That is some kind of interaction between Tom Holland and Tom Hardy. You know, I thought I was going to get it. I thought I was going to get some Venom in there somewhere. And with the exception of a mid-credit scene, no, that didn't happen. And that's the only thing I was just like, damn it. I wanted to see that. But other than that, man, I'm done. That's it. There's my list.
Mine was... You know, the movie isn't like super polarizing, but the people that don't like it just really don't like it. And I looked at those concerns before I went to see the movie and I saw some of it, man. Like, the big thing is there's no plot. You know what I mean? Like, the plot of this movie is, how can I make getting into college as cosmically complicated as possible?
That is true. The whole plot of this movie is around getting Peter Parker and his friends into college.
So...
It's crazy.
So, I...
I mean, it's like, you're right. Wow, that is a...
That's the whole plot. Like, I get it, man. Like, you're trying to save the villains, whatever. But that's like, that's not the reason for the movie. The reason for the movie is your everyone knows you're Spider-Man.
Yeah, without the other villains showing up, it's like, do we need to see that? No, it is a whole bunch of fan service in a How to Get into College movie. Now you say that, now I'm bummed out because you're right. You're right.
But no, don't bum out.
I loved it.
No, yeah, this movie's too good to care.
Yeah, that's the other thing. It's just like you say that. I didn't even notice. I was so happy with what I was getting sitting there in a movie theater. I clapped. I stood up. I was surrounded. The other thing is, now we're getting to the pros. I was surrounded by people that were doing the same thing as me, man. Like, everyone was excited. It was like, and again, if you ask me who my favorite Spider-Man is, I guess I don't have a favorite, but there are people there, you know, their first Spider-Man movie was The Amazing Spider-Man. And like, people get excited when they saw Andrew. You're like, that, because that's their Spider-Man. It's like, holy shit, that's my boy. And then there are people that are like, Tobey Maguire is their Spider-Man. It's who they prefer. It's like, holy shit, he's here.
Right.
And then you have guys that are like me. He's like, hey, man, you all did a great job. And I'm so thankful that Tom Hardy's Spider-Man right now. You know what I'm saying? Because
you mean Tom Holland?
Tom Holland is Spider-Man right now.
You got venom on the brain.
I have so much venom on the brain. It's better than poison, I suppose. Oh!
But let's not dive too deep into it. Let's dial the clock back.
Okay.
I guess the first thing, though, before we jump into that is the big thing I thought of when I first started making my notes for this show was, we have so many iterations of these characters now, across all three franchises. So who is your favorite, like, Peter Parker?
Ooh,
not Spider-Man, but Peter Parker.
I tell you what, my favorite, man, don't make me pick.
That's the point.
It's like your kids are sitting here at the table. You're like, I like you.
It's Spidey's choice.
Oh yeah, Spidey's man. If I had to pick my favorite Peter Parker, I think it is Grant. You know what? We haven't known Tom Holland's Peter Parker without being Spider-Man. You know, we don't know the nerdy kid except the little flashbacks you get that he's not the coolest kid in school. You know what I'm saying? So if you had to pick one that we actually got to live a day in the shoes of Peter Parker pre getting bit by a spider, you have to pick either Toby or Andrew. And I think Andrew, you incredibly attractive young man, you don't get to be the best Peter Parker because you're so cool. So at the end of the day,
he's too pretty.
At the end of the day, Tobey Maguire, you are the best Peter Parker. Because I never once was like, damn it, why do they have to pick him to be Peter Parker? It's like, hey, yeah, you know, you fit the bill. So good job, buddy. But Andrew Garfield, you're too cool. You're too cute. Good job. And then Tom Holland, I don't know dweeby Tom Holland. So there you go.
I think for me, it kind of has to be Toby.
Okay.
I think is the best all-around Peter Parker. And you know, that you made a good point with, you know, Garfield is a lot of generations for Spider-Man, but, and we'll get into this, but that movie or that reboot was kind of doomed from the start because it was a cash grab reboot. Yeah. They didn't want to let it go, but again, we'll get into that. But yeah, I love Toby as Peter Parker. How about Spider-Man? What's your favorite Spidey?
Tom Holland.
Tom Holland's your favorite Spidey?
Yeah, favorite Spidey. He,
now, why though? Why does he? Because for me, it's Garfield.
Okay,
I think Garfield was the best Spider-Man. So what puts Holland above the other two?
One of the first scenes we get as Garfield as Spider-Man is when he's like picking, you know, kind of toying with the bad guy with a knife. And he's like, "Oh, I'm so sorry." And he's just like whipping him up with webs against the wall, and he's like,
right.
And I'm like, "Dude, you're being an asshole." You know what I'm saying? It's just like, but like, got him.
But like, Spidey was always quippy like that.
I understand that, but you go and show me Tom Holland where he's fighting like a regular Joe and he's being an asshole to him. Like, that doesn't happen. It's just like Spider-Man, he whips him up, strings him up in the ceiling, and he leaves. calls the police and he leaves. You know what I'm saying? Now, with Andrew Garfield, in that one scene, Andrew Garfield, now again, it's not Andrew Garfield, but his take on Spider-Man or how he was directed to play Spider-Man, that one scene, I was just like, so Andrew Garfield is my least favorite Spidey.
Wow. I've never really heard that. I've heard least favorite Peter Parker. Yeah. I've never heard least favorite Spidey with Garfield. That's an interesting take.
Yeah. But again, it all comes back to that first scene. And that's one of the first scenes we see Andrew as Spider-Man, is he's literally being an asshole to this guy at some point. Yeah, he's a crook or whatever, but Spidey's picking on him. He's being a bully, and which Spider-Man is not a bully. And so that's it. Sorry, that's how I was introduced to Andrew Garfield playing Spider-Man. And it's coming off of Tobey Maguire's Spider-Man. He never did anything like that to like a regular Joe. Yes.
No, at least not pre-symbiote.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Well, yeah. But then again, that's
Venom. That's dead. Not. Yeah.
That's Black Suit Spider-Man. Before his disco walk.
Now, how about Aunt May? Because Aunt May has gotten increasingly younger, excuse me, and hotter with each franchise, dude. So, I mean, I might have to just immediately go Tomei because just for my cousin Vinny vibes.
Yeah. You know? I do not know the actress's name off the top of my head, but the first actress that portrayed Aunt May is in my psyche. Aunt May.
That was very like comic and cartoon accurate for sure.
Yeah, and that is Aunt May is a little old lady who we feel sorry for because she loses her husband, Uncle Ben. Spoiler alert. For the millionth time in the Spider-Man.
If you guys haven't checked out Spider-Man ever in your life, you might want to turn off the podcast.
Because you might get some spoilers about radioactive spiders biting a teenager to give them superpower vibes. You know what I'm saying?
By the way, we are 100% assuming that you guys, you know, watched fucking No Way Home and you know what happens. Why else would you watch this roundtable?
And yeah, if you're here right now, everything's already been spoiled. All the good most of the good shit's already been spoiled.
That's true. The studios are like, fuck, it's been a week. We can put everything out there in the world. Yeah. That's why, you know, man, it's been a long time. Maybe I think the last one might have been like, you know, the end game is up there in Star Wars. But it's been a long time that I was like, I fucking have to see this movie the day it opens.
Yep.
Otherwise, I know not only, A, it's going to get ruined for me, but I want to be one of the first people to see what's going on. Even though some stuff was going around the internet already, like by the time I went to go see it, it was already like, there's probably the other two. And but it wasn't confirmed, and I was trying to keep it at arm's length. And it was great. I'm glad I didn't wait.
Man, I was just on YouTube. I wasn't looking for anything. It popped up in my feed because I'd been watching the trailers. I've been watching reviews of the people that got to see it, watching all my non-spoiler reviews of this movie. And then YouTube's algorithm, I got two videos that popped up on my feed. The first one is No Way Home Spider-Man talking about Uncle Ben.
Fuck.
Not Spider-Man, Spider-Man.
Right.
Talking about Uncle Ben. And I read it. I'm like, the fuck is this? And it was the scene where they're both standing on like the trip where they go down to meet Tom Holland Spider-Man. It's the other two Spider-Men, Toby and Andrew, that hop down and they go see Tom. And he's sitting there crying about Aunt May. And so that was their silhouette, though, was, you know, against in the moonlight. And I was like, these motherfuckers. This is on YouTube. And so, and then the next one next to that was the all three of them standing around in that little circle talking about how they have to work together. Like that was little video clips that had been pirated onto YouTube. And I was just like, now in my psyche, or did I figure like with all the hype going on that these two guys are going to be in the movie? Yes. But how awesome would it have been, Billy?
Yeah.
To just have them show up on screen without any kind of foreshadowing or any kind of warning or anything, man. Without any, like, just, oh, it, like the gravitas of Andrew Garfield running through that portal that nobody knew was going to show up, and he pulls off his mask and it's fucking Andrew Garfield. the world would have been set on fire if there was no internet. You know what I'm saying?
Right, right.
And everybody would walk out screaming to the heavens about how awesome that scene was. You know, and the same thing, like, you know, 2 minutes later, Tobey Maguire walks through a portal again, just... But so I had that little bit taken from me. You know, I didn't get to enjoy that for what it was. It's like, okay, finally, they're here. Let's go.
So your favorite Aunt May is the first one, which I can't remember her name either, unfortunately. Yeah. I apologize. Hope she's still alive because she was pretty old. But so she's your favorite one?
Yes.
Rock
out of,
on.
Out of, you know, and I'm not going to, and the other thing is that doesn't mean that I dislike Marissa or Sally Field. You know,
no, it's just, it's the preference. And I think up until Marissa Tomei, I gave it to the same, to that same actress for sure. Because of that, because she was so perfect as far as the comics and the, and the cartoons go. But there is something a little special about Sally Field as Aunt May, but it's, I don't know. There's just something a little too skewed with how they wrote her character that just made it, I don't know. Just, she's probably at the bottom for me.
Okay. Now, this is something I want to give you full disclosure. And don't judge me.
Okay.
Never saw Amazing Spider-Man 2.
That's fair.
Still haven't done it. Again, it's also...
But, well, so that's interesting. You never saw ASM 2, but you were still able to get the full richness out of No Way Home?
Yeah, absolutely.
Rock on.
Yeah.
It's great.
And now when we get there, I'll tell you why I like something that I took away from No Way Home, but we'll get there when we get to the end of this. And I'll explain that, or do you want me to talk about it right now? I can do whatever you want me to do.
Let's hold off.
All right, yeah, because it's there. That's one of the key points is what I took away at the end of No Way Home.
So how about Uncle Ben? And there's really only two options. There's because there wasn't an Uncle Ben for Tom Holland, unless you want to count Tony Stark as his Uncle Ben, which he was up until that fateful scene in No Way Home.
Yeah.
But Tony Stark was really his Uncle Ben for us.
Yeah.
For the audience, he was the Uncle Ben. Yeah. So basically, do you want to go with Sheen or the other guy?
Oh, my goodness. I'm going to go with the other guy only because... Only because, I guess. Because that was my first Uncle Ben on the big screen.
Sure.
So there you go. It's a cop-out. He's the first one I saw, so he's my favorite.
They really casted that movie well.
Yeah.
Like, if you go back and watch that original trilogy, the casting is awesome.
Yeah.
It's fantastic. I don't know. I might Ed Sheen, just because it was so weird and he played it so cool. The one scene when he embarrasses him in front of Gwen... It's like he's got you on his computer.
Oh, yeah.
Anyway, yeah. Look like a fucking creeper, dude.
Definitely had some more screen time over the other one, I believe.
Which I think made his death slightly richer.
Yeah, you're right. But it made it richer. And then if you want to include, you get asked me from the original Spider-Man trilogy who really killed Uncle Ben. Nobody knows because he was killed by the Sandman. He was killed by the robber. He was killed by somebody else, I'm sure. If you go back and rewatch it, it's like, who really killed Uncle Ben? Apparently it was Flint Marko, a.k.a. the Sandman, or was the robber that fell to his death in the first Spider-Man movie. No one knows, man. They kept rehashing who killed Uncle Ben throughout that original trilogy.
Yeah, that's something I didn't like. So throughout the show... To our listeners out there, I have several visual aids that I'll be popping up as we talk about certain things. When I got to, a few years ago, I got to go to Philly and they had a Marvel exhibit there. And man, it was fascinating. They had so many cool stuff. They had original artwork. They had displays from the movies, original props. So I grabbed some of the things that were relevant to this conversation and I'll be thwipping them up at you.
Ooh, the old thwip.
Thwip, thwip. So let's talk about Willem Dafoe's Goblin, man, because I love Willem Dafoe.
Yeah.
I think he's an amazing actor. And even though it was basically just two action figures,
yeah,
you know, on the screen against each other, it was still really, really cool. How did you feel when you saw Green Goblin on the screen for the first time? Do you remember? It was a long time
ago.
Well,
the first time I saw him, I was just like, I did not like the robotic-esque. Like, he looked like a robot. He didn't look like a guy in a costume. He looked like a robot. The first time we see Green Goblin in full attire. But you want to talk about casting choices when it comes down to, like, everyone who's been cast and all these comic book roles. And we throw Hugh Jackman up there and Heath Ledger. Dude, Willem Dafoe does not get near enough credit.
No.
The argument is he was only really in one movie until we got... No, well, he pops up in the original trilogy talking to Harry Osborn. But Willem Dafoe's Green Goblin, Norman Osborn, is freaking awesome.
Yes. Pitch perfect.
And so, like, I think it's a shame when we talk about the greats that have played comic book characters and the people that have been born to play roles. It's like, you want to talk about a guy who looked like he just had to put his shoes back on to play Green Goblin. I'm serious. That's what he did. He literally, like, Willem Dafoe woke up, got a phone call, said, hey, you want to be in this movie? He's like, you're going to be the Green Goblin / Norman Osborn again. And he's like, yeah, sure, let me put my shoes on. You know, and then boom, and there he is. You know what I'm saying? It was freaking amazing.
I love that.
Yeah.
I love that attitude. It just goes to show you what an awesome human he is. Not just a player, but just human.
Yeah, dude. I mean,
you know, a lot of people would be like, oh, why? You got what? Yeah, I'll come play, man. Fuck play. Yeah.
It's like, and I don't think that's, and remember the last iteration of the Green Goblin we got was, again, The Amazing Spider-Man 2, which I did not see. I just heard a lot of people could have done without.
Oh, yeah. You know, actually, that's so forgettable. I forgot all about that.
I haven't seen it, you know, and I know it was there because, and that's only because.
It wasn't even Norman. It went right to Harry.
Yeah. And again, the whole reason I know about it is because of the negative reaction it got.
Right. I rewatched all these movies leading up to No Way Home.
Mm-hmm.
And even before seeing No Way Home, I'm going to tell you now, rewatching those movies with even the idea in your head that it's a multiverse,
yeah,
makes them so much better.
Yeah.
And something else I noticed rewatching is Feige is in the credits. Kevin Feige has been at Marvel and helping with these movies since X-Men 2000.
Holy shit.
But no one knew who he was. He didn't have hardly any power. You know, he'd make notes and they'd be ignored, or so I hear. It's only until after the success of, like, the Avengers and whatnot that he started to become taken seriously. But, man, he has been part of this Marvel DNA
for
21 years at least.
And that doesn't include the casting process for X-Men 2000. So he's probably been in it longer than that.
Right.
Trying to get everything moving.
Right. Like, he's been, because it's so easy for us to forget he is Marvel. He's not Disney. He's Marvel.
Oh, yeah.
He's from Marvel Studios. He's not from Disney Studios. So he's been, like I said, he's just been part of this DNA telling these stories. Amy Pascal, too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, for this infinite amount of time, or 21 years.
It's like not infinite, quite infinite.
Quite infinite.
There is a hard cap on how long he's been doing it.
Yeah. So it's got to be super fucking cool and fulfilling that not only did they get to finally wrap up, you know, this Spider-Man arc, but they wrapped up the other two Spider-Man arcs in a beautiful way.
Yeah. That's one of the things that I want to talk to you that I had in my brain is there's the one thing I took away from this is just like, and we could sit there and we could rag on Spider-Man 3. Not a whole lot of people like Spider-Man 3 and not nobody, but a lot of people didn't care for The Amazing Spider-Man 2. For what they are, though, there is a lot of people that worked on that, storyboarded it, made fucking a movie. You guys, you go get cut a check and then get told, hey, you got to go make a Spider-Man movie. See how good you do.
Right.
So I think at the end of it, though, one of the things I took away from No Way Home is, like, Sony itself is proud of their little Spider-Man movies, man. That's what I took away. I was just like, you know what? We're going to bring this stuff back and we're going to show you that with maybe just a few tweaks, these other movies that maybe you didn't think were the greatest things in the world, with just a few little tweaks, they could have been masterpieces. You know, we could, like, there may not be Spider-Man in the MCU if these guys fire on all cylinders, if there isn't as much, you know, not as many chefs in the kitchen or whatever the drama was with the production of Spider-Man 3 and The Amazing Spider-Man 2. Without, if those two movies, like, hit it off, they're not divisive, you know, Sam Raimi could be on his, like, sixth, seventh film right now. You know what I'm saying? Tobey Maguire could still be Spider-Man. That is without, you know, anyway, I don't know where this tangent is going, but I just know that at the end of the day, that's what I, one of the things I took away from the movie is that Sony was proud of their first trilogy and they were proud of the Amazing Spider-Man movies. I can't say trilogy, and so that's hard to do, but it's like,
yeah, I don't know if I like super agree with that, but I do agree with the notion of like, look, man, people like poured their souls.
Yep.
And it takes a lot to make a movie, man. And whether it's shitty or not, like the people that actually work on it, like it's not their fault.
Yeah.
It's, you know, that might sound real stupid, but the people, the crew,
yeah,
you know, even the director to an extent, like with big movies like that, sometimes it's not their fault.
Yeah.
But I do want to get into something. We're jumping a little bit ahead, but
I'm sorry.
But no, but it does, it goes together. Raimi does kind of cop out on Spider-Man 3. He's quoted in a number of places at blaming the studio, which fair enough, you know, I'm sure they had a big hand in it. But dude, the fucking like this scene, like woo, like that's all you, Sam, baby. Like that's no one else's choice. Yeah,
you show me a Sony exec that came to your set and went to your storyboard and went to your writer and was like, if this movie doesn't get made, if we don't get Peter Parker doing a disco strut down the street.
the now dig on this. That was all Sam Raimi. I don't give a fuck what anyone else says, dude.
Now dig on this.
Jesus Christ.
Oh, that's another part we haven't touched on. I don't know if you meant to, if it's in the works, MJ or the love interest.
Yeah, and MJ is a big thing I want to talk about, but I want to get to another visual aid real quick because it has to do with Spider-Man 1.
Oh, let's do it.
Do you remember the poster getting pulled, the original poster?
Is it the Twin Towers?
It is. Check this out, man. So this is the original teaser poster for Spider-Man 1 with Tobey Maguire. And if you look, there's a reason it was pulled right after 9/11.
Oh,
that's right. Why it was pulled, because it shows the twin towers in his eye there reflected. I don't even really understand why they made that choice. Because for, you know, I've always heard that people considered the twin towers that they were like an eyesore in the New York skyline.
Yeah.
But so I'm not sure what preempted this, because this is pre 9/11.
Yep.
This wasn't like an homage.
Yeah.
To 9/11. This was pre 9/11. They chose to put that reflection in his eyes, and then it got pulled for good. I mean, it's good that it got pulled. Like,
yeah,
I'm fine with that. And now this one sheet is like a giant collector item. You know what I mean?
If this was, you know, if this is how they wanted to showcase what city he's in or something, and you're just basically doing it off of the reflection of his eyepieces, you know, you ask me, a guy who lives in Florida,
right,
could I tell you what building was reflecting off his eyepieces, if it was the Chrysler Building or the Empire State Building, Trump Tower, if it was anything like that, would I be able to tell you? No. But ask me even pre, you know, 9/11, could I pick out what the Twin Towers looked like? Yeah. So I think that's why they used, and if you go back, there's like a trailer that got pulled and everything that used.
Oh, really? There was a trailer too?
Oh, hell yeah. There was a trailer that it was a helicopter.
I didn't know that.
There was a helicopter caught in a web that was strung up between the two towers. There's a trailer out there. That, like, it was the first teaser trailer of Spider-Man. It was a helicopter that had been caught in a web that was strung up in between the two towers.
Can you imagine being like a CG artist or a producer, an exec producer, anyone in that chain of command that has to wake up on September 12th and be like, we have to cut all of this?
Yeah.
I wonder how big of a part the Twin Towers played in the script. Because you're right, man. Like, I might recognize the Empire State Building for sure, but Twin Towers, like, I get it. Like, it's a really good point. But man, I wonder how much they had to change.
Yeah,
that would be because of it.
That would be a good question to ask or research or ask somebody involved with that first movie.
Yeah, if anyone knows anyone that knows anyone that worked on the original Spider-Man movie, particularly CG artists, you know, comment below, because I would love to know the story behind that, man.
Because you're right, in the advertisements as we saw from that poster, and I distinctly remember the trailer. We could probably look it up as soon as we're done here. I distinctly remember the trailer that had the helicopter stuck in a web in between the Twin Towers. It's probably on YouTube somewhere.
Let's see if we can find it. Fuck it. Okay, so Empire State.
Shut her down. Uh-huh. Looks like.
Got some guardsmen.
Yeah, guardsmen, Columbia.
What the fuck is...
Uh-oh. It's like some kind of heist.
Just like straight up bank robbers.
Yep.
This is kind of a boring teaser, to be honest with you.
Well, it's boring in 2020.
Nokia, dude. Nokia. Fucking Nokia bricks. Oh, wow.
You gotta get out of here. We're the super cool guys.
Okay.
Brought grapple hooks and a helicopter to your heist. Okay, that's very
This cool. is basically the start of The Dark Knight.
Yeah, looks good. Looks good.
Uh-oh.
Uh-oh.
Oh, all the money.
Oh, what's going on here? Oh!
God, that looks so bad. That looks so terrible, dude. I wonder what this, like, originally played on. See, I can imagine getting hyped at that reveal.
Do-do-do.
Wow.
Watch out, here comes a Spider-Man.
Really? Next summer. Okay, so that's why the poster was like that. All right, so it was basically born from the trailer.
Yeah.
Spin your webs.
Spider, your man.
Spider-Man, coming May 2002.
Holy God, that movie's 20 years old next year.
I keep forgetting it's 2002. I always think Spider-Man 2 is 2002 for some reason.
Because it makes sense with the twos.
Yeah. Wow, well, that was cool to kind of dip into.
Yeah.
Man, I would imagine, apart from how recognizable the towers were, also they're one of the highest points in the city.
Yeah.
So that makes it stand out.
I'm like, that's a little bit of a hazard, though. So you're telling me rescue workers got to get up there and get those guys.
Yeah, Spider-Man had no consideration for who would have to clean that shit up.
Yeah.
And they'd have to do it in 2 hours.
Yeah. Or else it's just going to free fall down the ground. I know some helicopter pilots will tell you that as much as you want your engines to rev up some propellers, not propellers, oh my God, a rotor head. And the time it's going to take you to hit the ground from that height. Nah.
Wow.
Straight down.
Did you know Elfman did the score?
I think so. I think I knew that.
I'm sure I recognized his sounds, but, you know, I was so young when these movies came out. I was a young teenager. I wouldn't have known
who he was.
Yeah. And then as an adult, you don't really watch these movies anymore because the stigma is that they suck, quote unquote.
Yeah.
But rewatching them again, like, oh shit, Danny Elfman, I can totally hear that. Yeah. I totally hear the Batman in this score. Yeah. And it does kind of give like an extra creepy edge to the character.
Oh yeah. It sounds like a spider crawling. It's like,
yeah, the fucking, the dum, dum, And it sounded so familiar that it took me down the rabbit hole. I'm like, you know what? This fucking sounds like Men in Black.
Yep.
And I looked it up. Sure as shit, he did Men in Black 2 as well. Or he didn't do Men in Black 2. He did Men in Black as well.
Now I'm going to go on my little Danny Elfman tangent. You want to know what he fucked up for me, Billy?
I want to actually guess.
Guess. It's one movie that is sorely missing its theme, except for like two little snippets.
I'm going to guess Transformers?
No.
No?
Avengers Age of Ultron.
He did Age of Ultron?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yep. And there's only like the iconic Avengers theme. There's like little bits of it in the movie because he says, end quote, "When I hear temp music, I listen to it one time and then I don't listen to it again." So there's like two little hums of the now iconic Avengers theme throughout all of Avengers Age of Ultron. And if I may use your podcast to say this, Billy, fuck you, Danny Elfman.
I guess Silvestri was busy.
I don't know.
Like, it's so weird that they would pull Elfman for Ultron.
I have no idea. But like that entire like fight when they're fighting in their circle, know what it sounds like? Spider-Man, Men in Black. It sounds like all of his shit. When they're all fighting all the Ultron robots in that little circle around the "I'm going to blow up Sokovia" button. It's literally like, where the hell is my Avengers theme song? It's like,
I'll have to watch it again.
That's all it is for however fucking long that fight scene. Look, I'm now cussing, Billy.
All right, we'll pull it back into Spider-Man. Yeah, we'll pull it back into Spider-Man. So going back to the first flick, man, we already mentioned Willem Dafoe and how great he was, but you know, with the action figure thing, but how much of a great actor is this guy that he got us to believe in it just from emoting from his eyeballs? Yeah, just the fucking the crazy
eyes, the eyes wide open eyes. Peter.
Yeah.
Dude, because, you know, and I think they bring it up in No Way Home, is the dude without a mask, no offense, Willem, kind of looked like a fucking goblin. But I'm sure he digs it, man. He knows he's got that creepy ass grin and he gets the crazy eyes. Good on you, man. I can't pull that shit off.
In this movie, we get our first taste of J. Jonah Jameson since the cartoon.
Oh, man.
And again, going back to casting, perfect.
Perfect.
Perfect. So much so that they recasted him. But this, again, was in the exhibit from the original cartoon. But I think J.K. Simmons as J. Jonah Jameson is one of the best things about all three of those movies, man.
You will hear me not debate you at all on that topic.
What's your favorite scene of the trilogy, like of him ranting?
Oh my god. The one where I think it's Spider-Man 2 and JJ has got the spider suit.
Sure.
And he's doing his little heartfelt thing about how much the world might need Spider-Man or the city needs Spider-Man. And then that's the point where,
like, Spider-Man, he's lamenting about he caused him to quit.
Yeah, and then Spider-Man steals the suit off the wall. He's like, he's a menace. So there, he instantly goes back to how Spider-Man is a menace to the city now. But at, like, one of my favorite lines is "Do you trust anyone, JJ?" And he's like, "I trust my barber."
I love that. That's a great line, dude.
That's it. You know, that's like my favorite line. I trust my barber, you know. And I'm not trying to knock JK because I'm sure, you know, he put a lot of heart into that role because I'm sure he loves it as well. But I'm sorry. I know JK Simmons listens to this, and I want you to know that I'm sorry that my favorite line you presented was, "I trust my barber."
It's the delivery, dude. It's the delivery. It's just perfect. Yeah, I think just anytime he's on a multi-angled rant, yeah, I really enjoy, because I work in broadcasting, so the ability to multitask slamming multiple people and never lose your concentration, it's very spot on and great for that character.
The only thing I didn't like is when he was on all of his meds Now, how he portrayed J.K., or excuse me, how J.K. portrayed, like, I'm going to get them all mixed up because it's J.K. and J.J. So when J.J. was taking his meds and he wasn't able to yell, he's like, thank you. And he's slowly taking his meds.
Do you think that first trilogy wasted Connors? Because they set him up in the first movie, and that first movie, the first two movies are really well balanced.
Yeah.
And they have a good pace.
Yep.
But, you know, and Connors was in both flicks, and they even made a point to not show his arm. Like, if you watch it closely, they never really show that he doesn't have the arm.
Yeah.
He's always kind of like standing in this weird way. So did you miss having Lizard?
No, I didn't miss not seeing the Lizard in the original trilogy. I was more concerned with, you want to talk about a gripe I had, in particular with comic book movies in the early 2000s. They were killing everybody. They were killing all their villains. Like, Green Goblin got a movie. Doc Ock got a movie. And then, so to get Connors, like, I guarantee you, if Connors would have became the Lizard, guess what? That's a dead Lizard. He would have died. Just because, sure, that's what they did. They don't want to have to rehash anybody. And instead of bringing Willem Dafoe back as Green Goblin, they made Harry Osborn new Goblin, which James Franco, right? That's someone else we haven't talked about, is James Franco in that original trilogy. Comes back as the new Goblin, and yeah, so
with no real name, like, everyone just kind of assumed Hobgoblin, but
yeah,
he was just
the new Goblin.
He was just ninja on a hoverboard.
Boo.
Let's dip into Spider-Man 2. Even now, yeah, even with Avengers, Endgame, Infinity War, No Way Home. Well, maybe it changes with No Way Home now. Maybe, yeah, that conversation is different. But for some reason, Spider-Man 2 is still considered by fans one of the best superhero movies, yeah, ever made. And I'm just real curious, man. Like, why do you think that is? Like, why is that particular movie beat out? Maybe not beat out, but is still holding its own and punching above its weight class with these other movies?
To me, it's two things. We see how big of a pain in the ass it could be to be a superhero trying to lead a regular life. And Tobey Maguire / Peter Parker is so, what's the word I'm trying to find? He's so conflicted about what he wants. It actually starts costing him his powers. Okay, fine. In a movie, maybe it doesn't work, but that's explained a little bit better, I guess, in comics. So that really does happen in the comics. He just wills his powers away and he loses a little bit of edge or whatever. The other thing is, we have a sympathetic villain, a guy that we're like, oh man, that's shitty. Yeah, he's a bad guy and he's doing bad things and it needs to be stopped.
But it's not really, like, kind of his fault, but not, yeah, really his fault.
It's like, oh man. And then, of course, we have our, oh my God, when a villain realizes that what he's doing is wrong and he snaps out of it. What's that word called?
Epiphany?
Not an epiphany. It's like a, gosh,
conscience?
Yeah. He grows a conscience all of a sudden and he overcomes, which, again, in No Way Home, Peter Parker makes a thing where he overcomes his tentacles. But in Spider-Man 2, he naturally overcomes the tentacles. And he becomes a good guy at the very end and sacrifices himself to, you know, save the world, at least New York. I don't know if it's the world at that point. But I think it is. Isn't that the one where, is that the one where Mary Jane almost gets married? Or is that 3?
No, that's the second one. Yeah, she's going to marry
Flash.
Or no. You're right. It is the third one because,
okay,
because that's the one with Venom. She's, yeah, going to marry Jonah's son, yep, the astronaut. Yeah.
But anyway, I think those are the two, in my opinion, the two big reasons why Spider-Man 2 is, like, hailed. And, like, the fight scenes are awesome. Doc Ock looks on par with Spider-Man. You can see how they could go toe-to-toe. And he escapes a couple of scraps of Spider-Man simply by making Spider-Man choose. Like, he saves a train. Doc Ock gets away.
Dude, that train scene.
And the train scene's awesome.
Like, that train, it still gives me chills. And I don't know what it is about how we connect when a superhero is finally unmasked, like, or even not unmasked, but when someone knows about a superhero's identity, it I don't know, there's something validating about that of like, someone knows what I'm going through, man. Someone knows my triumphs. And that scene after he stops the train and they're like, he's just a kid.
Yeah, yep, he's just a kid.
I fucking lose it every time, man. Because especially when, oh my God, dude, when the one guy is like, puts his hand on his shoulder and is like, he's like, it's okay. Like,
yeah,
it's okay.
Yeah.
Man. Man.
It's a good movie.
It's a real good movie.
It's a great movie. If y'all haven't seen Spider-Man 2 in the last few years, go plug it in. It's a really good watch.
You know, and just aesthetically, the effects are light years ahead of the first one.
Yeah.
Like, it was leaps and bounds. It's still even kind of, like, some scenes are kind of rubbery.
Yeah.
When it's, like, just all CG.
Yeah.
Fight, but it's even that, like going back to the train scene. Train scene's kind of flawless.
Yeah.
CG wise.
We can sit here and you could do a whole damn podcast about that train scene. It's a good, I would. Yeah. It's an amazing scene.
Who shoehorned the my dick doesn't work metaphor into the plot? Because the big thing of that was like he couldn't always use his powers and he gave up for a little while and he was like, oh, I'm just going to be a happy-go-lucky guy, and I'm going to do my homework. And
well, I don't know.
But even before that, he was having, like, performance issues.
I don't know, man. I don't know who shoehorned it in. I know that there is, again, there's a bit in the comics where he doesn't want to be Spider-Man anymore, and he hangs it up, and his powers do tend to leave him. So I think it was somebody trying to give, you know, the comic book fans a bone. You know what I'm saying? It's like, here you go. It's like we know our source material, and so here we go.
I don't want to shit on Kristen Dunst too much because I like her, you know, whatever. Yeah. But she didn't play the best MJ throughout, and it could be as simple as it just wasn't written very well. She was very like me.
Yeah,
you know, throughout the whole thing. But they get together in the second one at the end. Dude, that last scene of them getting together.
Yeah.
Ugh.
My whole thing, okay, now I don't want to hurt anybody's feelings. And I love you.
Or wait, they don't even get together in the second one, do they? It's the third one.
Yeah. They get together at the very end of the third one. No, anyway, so what makes me, like, I don't want to offend anybody or upset anybody who loves Kirsten Dunst. And Kirsten, I'm sure you're out there and you're a wonderful person. However, Mary Jane Watson is a bombshell. She is supermodel-esque hot.
100%.
And so when and how the whole intro that Mary Jane gets into Peter's life is like he's set up on a blind date and he doesn't want to go. And then he finally, you know, set up by Aunt May, by the way, and he finally goes and then it's Mary Jane. He's like, she calls him by his, you know, her nickname for him is like, let's face it, Tiger, you just lucked out, you know, and she knows. It's just like, she knows he's batting above. She knows he's out of his league, but, you know, she loves him anyway. And so, anyway, I think, so when it came down to Kirsten Dunst, I'm like,
I'm getting real fucking confused because I have in my notes, I meant to interrupt you, but
oh no,
I'm sorry I interrupted you.
That hurts my feelings.
So I have in my notes last scene with MJ and the last shot of MJ. So it had to have been the second one, not the third one where she was getting married.
It was the second one she was getting married.
Right. You're right. I was wrong. So it's the second one where she's getting married. So the last scene that I was originally talking about that I confused myself on is when she's in his apartment. You know, she leaves her wedding.
Yeah.
She realizes that everything that he'd let her down on was because he was Spider-Man and she was proud of him for being Spider-Man. So she wanted to be with him and is just like super standing in the doorway. Like that whole scene is just like super wholesome. And the thing where like, isn't it time someone saved you? Like, oh my God, dude, I love that shit, man. Like, It
you fucking nerd.
It gets me misty-eyed just talking about it, man. But there is a last shot. So there's the go get him, Tiger.
Yeah.
And that's one of my favorite things in comics, period. I have this piece I'm sending to the Frame Store. It's two books that I had Stan Lee signed, and some other things are going to go in the collage. But one of the books is the first MJ.
Mm.
And it's the Tiger, you hit the jackpot. So when she says, like, go get him, Tiger, I'm fucking all in. And but there's that last shot. He thwips away. And they just added this shot of her being, like, super bummed.
Yeah.
Like, why do you think they added that? Like, there was this whole... They just did this whole scene about how they're going to have this happy relationship. Yeah. And it's like she realizes, oh, I don't actually like this.
Yeah. Yeah. She, I think she understands. It's like, here, I'm here for you, and yada, yada, yada. And then she also realizes that I think she'll always, for the most part, come second to Spidey.
I'm sure that's what it is. I hated that shot.
No, I'm
sorry. Because it almost undercuts the entire scene.
Bill, I'm sorry.
I know.
There's nothing I can do about that. There's nothing anyone can do about that.
I think you're just not trying hard enough.
I'm trying to ponder that scene in my head, and I don't remember it.
Oh, okay.
I'm sorry.
It is a quick... I mean, I just rewatched these movies last week.
I have not.
Yeah. So I'm a little more prepared, I guess. So Spider-Man 3.
Ooh.
The hype for this movie, dude. Do you remember the hype for this movie? Yeah.
We were going to get Venom.
Get Venom, black suit, Spidey. Dude. Everyone was losing their fucking minds.
Dude, I remember being there. Like, this might be the last superhero movie I ever need to see.
Right.
I remember going in like, this is it. This is the one. We're going to get Venom, and then we're going to get 18 movies of Venom and Spidey fighting each other. It's going to be great. And then...
Again, they did great casting. I forgot Bryce Dallas Howard was in the fucking movie, I didn't realize it. Again, as an adult, I'm picking up all these new things.
Yeah.
Again, I think she could have made a great Gwen Stacy.
Yeah.
But they wrote her as just this dumb blonde who's in the middle of this fucking love square thing.
And that's right. It's not even a love triangle. It's a fucking love square.
Because she doesn't really like Peter.
Yeah.
But she probably could.
Yeah.
But he uses her because he likes MJ, and then there's Harry with MJ again, and it's all real fucked. It's such a convoluted fucking plot, dude.
And that's one of the con ticks for Spider-Man 3. I haven't even gotten that far into it.
Well, I mean, let's dive here. So with the massive convoluted plot, which villain would you cut? So we have
New Goblin. See how easy that was?
Well, now let me give you an alternate perspective.
Okay, go ahead.
I think you cut Sandman.
Okay.
Maybe you don't keep Goblin as is, but I think you need the Harry, because we've been through that for three movies now,
mm-hmm.
about how Harry just wants revenge with Spider-Man. So I think we need that closure,
mm-hmm.
but we don't need Sandman as great of a character as Sandman is. You alluded to this earlier in the podcast. It just confused everyone as to who Spider-Man should be mad at. And then it introduced the thing of like, oh, he kind of killed that guy in Spider-Man 1 for no reason. And now he has that demon to worry about. It's just, it was too much. Like, and the way he became Sandman, like, that's real fucking dumb. Like, no one could just like check to make sure it wasn't a fucking pigeon.
They brought, what was it? It was brought up in No Way Home. It's like, what happened to you? Fell into a collider. What happened to you? Fell into a vat of eels. People got to be watching where they fall. So, I mean, it's like, okay, so my thing is, if Harry really wanted revenge, now, again, maybe if the new Goblin is just done differently or something, I don't know, but why can't we get Harry Osborn hire somebody? He hires like a Bullseye or something.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I can see that. Or even pay off Connors, finally. Pay off the Connors thing.
Yeah.
Make him Lizard, and then in order for him to facilitate the cure, just like he did with Dr. Octopus, like, just go to fucking Harry and let him pay, like, okay, here, I'll pay for your serum, but you gotta fucking bring me Spider-Man. Like, yeah, it would have been double dipping, but I think it would have been a lot fucking better than what it was. And again, like, Sandman, like, the creation, like, all that was just super lazy writing.
Well, I enjoyed when Sandman was on screen. I enjoyed it too much. You know, I appreciated every scene.
They did a great fucking job of that, to be fair.
And so
CG.
I liked it so much. So if you ask me, hey, John, would you take Sandman out of Spider-Man 3? Absolutely not. I enjoyed the CG. I enjoyed a little bit of story. Yes, it's, you can't justify, it's like, your kid's sick, and no, you can't justify stealing money, you know, so, but again, they tried to make him a sympathetic villain, but at the end of the day, dude, you're still doing bad shit, you know what I'm saying, you're still a bad guy, and you come to terms with it, and you and Spidey agree not to do fisticuffs anymore, and you kind of just fade away into the sunset, and then bye.
Yeah, that's the other thing about this fucking movie, is, so, there's no consequences for Sandman?
Yeah, none. Whatsoever.
He's an escaped convict. He causes X damage to the city, kidnapping, and there's no repercussions for this guy. He just gets to fucking blow away into the sunset. Yeah,
let him go, man. Let him go.
Jesus.
But at the same time, I can forgive that a lot easier than forgiving New Goblin. Sorry. I've said it. I am standing my ground on this, Billy. I am not moving.
And, you know, I think if they cut either, whether it's Goblin or Sandman, I think we get a much better Venom at that point, too. The Venom in Spider-Man 3, just, there was no personality. It was just a fucking, it's just something they jerked out of their cocks and was like, let's put it in the script.
I'm not knocking Topher Grace. Not going to do it. But he shouldn't have been Eddie Brock. Sorry, buddy. Matter of fact, no, he wasn't Eddie Brock, by the way. Billy, did you know this? He was actually Eddie Brock Jr. So that means there's an Eddie Brock somewhere out there in that Spider-Verse.
I thought Eddie Brock was always a junior.
I don't know. But I'm just saying they could have saved it and brought in a different Eddie Brock.
Yeah.
See what I'm saying?
Yeah, that would have been cool.
They could have totally, like, revamped it in Spider-Man 4, if that was ever going to be a thing, you know, and brought in Eddie Brock as pissed off and hating Spider-Man.
Do you think maybe that was the thing, like, it, maybe one of two reasons, like, either they were looking forward to the fourth one and like, okay, we're going to jam all this shit in now and we'll pay it off in the fourth movie, or, oh, the fourth movie's already canceled, let's jam as much shit in here as we can.
I know that there is, like, it's on the internet, Spider-Man 4 was in the works. Like, they had figured out a lot of stuff. Like, it was going to be John Malkovich as the Vulture.
That would have been weird.
Who was it? Oh, my God. Everyone's favorite. Bruce Campbell. Bruce Campbell was going to be Mysterio. Like, they were... So, the plan was there to have a Spider-Man 4. But I think... And again, the rumor I hear was... Raimi wanted to do the Sandman, the studio wanted to do a Goblin, and then of course the fans, I forget, when did Spider-Man 3 come out?
04?
Really? No.
Well,
when was Spider-Man 2?
Amazing Spider-Man was only like in 07 or 06. Yeah, let's look it up.
Look it up real quick. Spider-Man 3.
I mean, I'm sure it's not 04. That's only 2 years after the first one, but...
You 2007.
Know, Amazing... 2007. Okay, so Amazing Spider-Man was, what, 2012?
Probably.
Yeah, I think that's more accurate. Yeah. So, 2007.
But, so, what I'm getting at is in 2002, we got Spider-Man.
Yeah.
So, the most diehard of... Not even the most... Like, fans of Spider-Man are like, how, like, in 2002, they asked the question, how long until we get Venom?
Yeah.
So 2007 gets, that's 5 whole years. You know what I'm saying? That's 5 years of like, hey, where is Venom? And so they, the studio felt the pressure. It's like, we got to do something. It's like, these people want this kind of thing. And
well, and to be fair, Venom was a lot later in Spider-Man's story mm-hmm. than I think people realize. Again, I think a lot of fans of this Spider-Man, like my generation, came from the 90s cartoon.
Yeah.
Where Venom and this black suited symbiote is literally within the first 10 episodes.
Yeah.
But it took 252 comics to get to the symbiote, to get to the black suit Spider-Man, let alone Venom. Like Venom was, yeah. was another 50 something issues.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I understand the fans wanting it because obviously movies are more compact, it's different media, but if there had been a fourth one, I think he would have been in the fourth one comfortably. Yeah.
But I, like I said, I think they were feeling it. And again, we can knock Spider-Man 3 out. It made a fuck ton of money.
Oh, I'm sure. Because of the hype. Like yeah. That hype we talked about, it was huge.
Yeah.
What grade was I in? I was 2007. So I was graduating high school.
Mm-hmm.
Fucking could not wait. I was even like, I don't care how fat I am. I need a black suit Spider-Man costume, man. I don't give a fuck. I'm wearing a black suit Spider. I didn't because, you know, whatever. But man, that's how hyped it was.
Nice.
I did go, like, the only other movie I was as. Yo, daddy. I don't know if you said that, but daddy-o.
But he should have daddy-o. Not to call this.
Oh, my God. Which, by the way, like, to circle back to that, to all that, you remember that dance scene, him dancing on the fucking sidewalk?
Yeah.
I thought it was kind of cute. Like, they even shot the reactions fans would have to that scene. Raimi shot people being disgusted on the street at Peter Parker in that scene. And what, it didn't occur to them that like this was a bad idea, that this is how people would actually fucking react? Like, you had the presence of mind to shoot it accurately of their reactions, and you nothing in you was like, maybe I shouldn't put this to fucking celluloid.
Oh my God. What are we missing? Are we missing anything from Spider-Man 3? Because we need to move off of this one.
Yeah, you're right. I think we're good with Spider-Man. The only other thing I had with Spider-Man 3 was when he was taking off the suit.
Yeah.
It was just like super irresponsible of him because Dr. Connors was like, this is bad. And then he found out how bad it was. And then he just like let it shed and didn't care about what happened to it.
I'm so angry. So angry. I'm going to turn green here in a second.
All right. So let's get into Amazing Spider-Man.
Let's do it.
I actually really loved the first Amazing Spider-Man.
Yeah, me too.
I think it had massive potential.
Yep.
Again, I just, and that comes from rewatching it.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, when I saw it originally, I was like, okay, this is good. But there was so much negativity like as much hype as there was for Spider-Man 3.
Yeah.
There was that much apprehension for Amazing Spider-Man 1.
Yeah.
Because it was all about Sony wanted to keep the property.
Yeah.
You know, Iron Man was starting, Thor was starting, you know, the MCU was budding, and we knew we were going to get Avengers eventually. So actually Avengers was close to coming out.
Was it? When was Amazing Spider-Man?
Amazing Spider-Man, I think, was 2012. So the MCU was mid phase one. A lot of fans were like, fuck you, Sony.
Yeah.
You won't let us have our Spider-Man. You know, we're not going to see.
It's a $1 billion franchise.
Right.
So it's a franchise that prints money. So no, they shouldn't give it back.
Well, they should have worked with, you know.
Personally, I never felt that way. I never felt any of the apprehension.
I totally did. I mean, I'm a huge Spider-Man fan, so I went to see it anyway. But I remember feeling that. And I remember feeling it with a lot of fans around me. But we were proven wrong.
Yep.
You know, it was a great movie. And again, great casting. Like, I think Emma Stone and Dennis Leary as the Stacys.
Yeah. Chef's kiss.
Especially Leary, man. Like, I'm a huge Dennis Leary fan when he's acting in something good.
Yeah.
So him as like the gruff NYPD cop, you know, after playing, he had just come off Rescue Me, I think.
Yeah.
So he had been an FDNY, acted as an FDNY firefighter. Now he's a cop and a captain. It was pitch perfect. It was great. And I'm a huge, I love Emma Stone so much.
Emma Stone is my favorite love interest out of all the Spider-Men.
She was far and away the best Gwen I think we could ever have.
Again, not even, I'm including MJ and Mary Jane in Spider-Man love interests. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, the best Gwen, yes. Best love interest, yes. Yeah.
Gwen, you know, for Spider-Man, Amazing Spider-Man, Amazing Spider-Man 2, it was all leading up to her death.
Yeah.
We all kind of knew it was going to happen. This is original artwork from that book. It's just heartbreaking.
It is still proclaimed as one of the most significant comic book deaths of all time. It is the death of Gwen Stacy.
Wasn't like Stan Lee like in Europe when they wrote this
story? Probably.
Because they had just killed the father.
Yeah.
They just killed Captain Stacy.
Yep. But without this, we don't get MJ.
No, but, you know, I've always considered Gwen, like, Peter's actual great love, like, the love of his life, yeah. And MJ is the, I don't know, the love he deserved, maybe?
Yeah, but, yeah, I don't know, it's sad. Makes me sad thinking about it.
Just look at that. Look at that emotion.
We'll get...
Just little scribbles, man, that...
Yeah. Man, dude, no, stop it. No, stop it. Get me all emotional. Out there in the universe, we've got Spider-Gwen, and I'm sure she's en route.
And you said you haven't seen Amazing Spider-Man 2, right?
I have not seen
it. Where she actually dies.
No, I mean, I've seen it.
Oh, man.
On the old Tinternet. I did a just like spoiler hunting for Amazing Spider-Man 2. Because I've never watched it. I have no idea what's happened. I know that I do not care for blue-skinned Electro.
No, it was real bad.
Yeah.
The thing with Death of Gwen, though, is they know that the audience knows it's coming.
Yeah.
So they fake you out literally three times with her falling. It's the fourth time that he actually snaps her. Oh. And in this one, it's snapped. Like, in the comics, it's... It's more like they say it's the fall that killed her, not his webbing. But in the movie, they go right for the webbing, man. Like, yeah, he killed her. And it's so, so fucking heartbreaking.
Oh, stop it, Billy. We were having a good talk and then you tell me that you're crying.
It still gets to me. And I thought this was kind of cool, like Stan Lee signing off on it. So I guess he knew about it, but I think they wrote it when he was out of town and they're like, what are you guys doing? They're going to think I have a vendetta against the Stacys.
But he messed it up. He messed it up. And then he messed it up. So yeah, you can go on your little talk about Amazing Spider-Man 2 if you want. And I'm going to be like, okay, because I haven't seen it. I know that there's some bad guys in it. I know that a lot of people had some not so nice things to say about Electro and the Green Goblin, but again, nobody knocked Andrew or Emma for their portrayal of their characters, and nobody really knocked Jamie Foxx. You know, it's just like the studio's idea to give him a fucking comb over. You know, it's like, hey, I got a great idea. let's make Jamie Foxx one of the coolest guys out there. Let's make him a nerd.
Which, no, to be fair, like the idea is cool, but the execution was terrible. The whole thing throughout both Amazing Spider-Man movies is they had this really unique Peter Parent arc that they never landed.
Yeah.
You know, throughout the whole first movie, there's the thing of like they had a runaway, but you don't know why, and there's a whole mystery about his dad and this formula, and they and the whole like opening 5 or 10 minutes of Amazing Spider-Man 2, it's about like how they died, and but they never land it. Like, that's it. They jam that in the beginning of Amazing Spider-Man 2 and then they just forget about it. Mm-hmm. Like, cool. Thanks for abandoning what could have been a cool plot point because you didn't know how to fucking write it. Jesus.
Oh, you bastards. Ugh.
I love, though, I did love how Gwen guessed at the promise Peter Parker made to Captain Stacy,
yeah,
about staying away from her.
Mm-hmm.
And then the payoff for us, I think that was great. And then for him to even go a step further later on, cause you think like, oh man, like really, like they're not going to end up together because of that bullshit. And he's like, but those are the best ones to break.
Ooh, sexy, sexy.
I really enjoyed their coupling, I guess.
Oh,
coupling. My notes here, just to see if there's anything specific that I want to touch on without having a conversation about it, apparently. Yeah, I do think they were rushing to make their own universe because they're like, oh, the first one turned out okay. Let's keep it going and keep it away from Marvel. And then they fucked it up again. Yeah, just everything's lazily written in that. Even like Harry Osborn's in that as the Green Goblin. And at one point they have this scene where Andrew Garfield goes, you're my best friend, Harry. And like, mm-hmm. when did you establish that they're best friends in this universe? Like we're just supposed to automatically assume.
Yeah.
He just showed up. Peter has never mentioned the Osborns.
Yeah. It's the, Obi-Wan and Anakin Skywalker are best friends because they tell us over and over and over again, as opposed to, oh, I don't know. Can we see those guys get a cup of coffee or something and maybe shoot some basketball together?
Right. Like, let's do a buddy montage, yeah, man. Have a
buddy montage, anything that constitutes you calling another person your best friend, especially on screen.
You're my best friend.
I can't imagine going through life without you. But I'm going to not do it because you're a bad guy.
I have in my notes here that the Green Goblin looked like a leprechaun fucked a gremlin.
That is very true. The stills, I'll agree.
So we'll skip ASM. We'll go right into MCU Spider-Man. We are now in Tom Holland territory,
yay!
Man.
Yay!
Where most of you have come to watch about, listen about, I'm sure. Civil War, dude. And we're not going to talk about the entirety of these movies.
No.
Obviously, we're just talking about the Spider-Man bits.
Yep.
I can't remember. Did we know we were getting Spider-Man in Civil War?
They straight put that dude in the trailer.
Really?
Front and center. Like that scene of him stealing Cap's shield.
It was in the trailer.
Is in the goddamn trailer of Civil War.
Wow. I had forgotten all about it because I guess it didn't hurt the scene, man, because I still remember the cheers of that scene.
Yep. And I mean, we can go on. Try not to get too much into the movie, but like Black Panther was in the trailer. Like they let everyone know how big this movie was going to be. And it did. I think you could check how much money that damn thing made. And a lot of that is like, who knows? It's literally seeing the interactions between Spider-Man and Cap. They have dialogue. Spider-Man and Iron Man, of course.
Brooklyn.
Queens. So it's awesome. Oh, you have a metal arm? That's so cool. Everything. Are those wings made out of carbon fiber? Because if so, that's pretty awesome.
Just like, you're normally not supposed to talk this much. It was.
What the hell is that? Everyone's got a gimmick.
What was your reaction like when, I guess like the shield stealing scene, but also just when we're introduced to Tom Holland's Peter Parker and Spider-Man?
Hey, May, there's this crazy car parked outside, and he turns around and sees Tony. And that scene right there, like, again, that enshrines Tom Holland is this skinny kid from New York who, you know, him and his aunt aren't well off. You know, he's got his little pizza shirt on. So I think that was like a callback to like one of his jobs or whatever. And then he has that little first encounter with Tony Stark in his bedroom. And they're just sitting there chit-chatting. And it's like, and that initial scene where Tony flips out his phone and he shows him, it's like, that's you, isn't it? And he's swinging and he catches that SUV. Right. That's a crash. It's like, it is.
The suit falling from the attic and him just like nonchalantly.
And then the whole whip, it's like, don't tell Aunt May. You know, it's just like, come on.
And it's just like, they haven't understood. He's like, well, get me out of this, man. Come on.
Oh, yeah, sorry.
We got shit to do.
It is great. Hey, you guys ever seen this really old movie? The Empire Strikes Back with the Walker thingies? Jesus, Tony, how old is this kid? I ain't carbon date him. He's a little on the young side.
Which I love that they kept that going into Infinity War of like, but the kids see more movies.
Dude, I mean, and again, that shows me like, I think Tom Holland right now is into his 20s, but in that scene, you know, he's a 15-year-old kid. You know, he's a 15, 16-year-old kid. It's like, this really old movie? When they're on the ice planet with the Walker thingies?
Nice to meet you, Spider-Man.
Yeah, it's like, hey, Captain Spider-Man.
Spider-Man.
It's so good. Like, anyway, that was our introduction, and it kind of like nonchalantly, like, you know, Iron Man's like, you're going home, or I'm telling Aunt May, and that's the end of Spider-Man in that movie. You know what I'm saying? It's him laying on the ground. It's like, no, I'm fine. It's like, no, you're going home, or I'm telling Aunt May.
He's like, no, okay, yeah, I'm done.
And so, I mean, yeah, effectively, that's the last we see a Spider-Man until the mid-credit scene. And anyway, it was great. It was at that moment. Well, I knew Marvel was just knocking them out of the park. Every movie they put out, just knocking them out of the park. And then now we have Spider-Man in the MCU. And I was incredibly excited. I was just like, man, let's go. Show me.
Spider-Man's always been, like, basically my favorite. Like, I'm a huge bat whore, huge Batman fan. But, like, Spider-Man is right there. And a lot of times above it, because what a lot of people don't realize is some of the best Batman stories aren't about fucking Batman.
No.
He's barely there.
Yeah.
You know, so having a superhero, like, front and center and just as well-rounded, especially in, like, crossover books, he's fantastic, like, Avengers vs. X-Men, and in the Civil War books, him unmasking himself, you know...
It's huge.
He's obviously, he's older, he's not 15, he's been Spider-Man for, like, 2 decades or something, but it's one of my favorite moments in comics, is when he unmasks himself with Tony, you know, to be Team Stark.
Yeah, that is... That's something that happens later on accident, but we'll get to that, I'm sure.
So Homecoming, I was not really a fan of Homecoming when I first saw it. And I don't really remember why. There was just something about it that I was like, eh. But since then, I've really become a fan of it. Like, Michael Keaton as Vulture is fucking great. And
I think it's, again, because we're introduced to Peter Parker's world. You know what I'm saying? We're introduced to the MCU's Peter Parker's world. He's in school, super smart. He's a part of all the honors classes. And that's when we get introduced to, you know, our supporting Spidey cast. You know, we get Ned and we get Flash. And
dude, Ned is MJ. All of us. Dude. Like, Ned just represents all of us. It's Ned so funny.
Every single person on planet Earth that wishes they can be Peter Parker's
FOS dude, friend of Spider-Man. You know, something I realized rewatching all this shit, Peter, you know, to dip into what we were talking about, Civil War, Peter was only like 10 when the Battle of New York happened.
That's the math.
So because... Homecoming was like 2016 and Avengers is 2012.
Yeah.
So 4 or 5 years difference, and that would make him 10, 11 years old.
Mm-hmm.
And that really explains his fandom. Like, I mean, if you met Captain America in person, you'd be a fan anyway. I mean, not me. I can't stand Captain America, but that's different. But, you know, if you're a kid and you see these gods save your city, like that, I don't think that's something we think about enough, is that's why he's always so fanboyish with all these Avengers, is because he was literally a kid.
Yeah.
You know, it'd be like watching Luke Skywalker blow up the Death Star and and all of a sudden you're in the Rogue Squadron with him, you know?
Oh, that'd be badass. I want to fly an X-Wing. Let's go get some X-Wings, Billy.
Get an X-Wing? Like Dune Buggy X-Wing, you know?
Around. Oh, so I guess we got to talk about Keaton. Was amazing as the Vulture. Was there any, there wasn't any... Oh, technically we got Mac Gargan, who will be the Scorpion, I'm assuming at some point. He was one of the thugs that got arrested, and he actually bumps into the Vulture in prison.
Yeah, now, correct me if I'm wrong, but wasn't the Vulture in the original No Way Home trailer? Or in one of them?
Yeah. Yeah, the Vulture wasn't... Yeah, it was... I mean, because it's Michael Keaton. You were promoting that Michael Keaton was in it, and he was the bad guy.
No. Not Homecoming. No Way Home.
Oh, no. He's been in the... He's in the Morbius trailer.
Okay. I'm getting it confused then because I thought, I originally thought they cut the Vulture out of the movie.
Oh, no, Billy, no.
Because, you know, a big thing I have about No Way Home is that they kind of almost did Sinister Six in one movie and rubbed it in Sony's face, man.
Yeah, almost.
Like,
I think they did that on purpose. I think they only had five on purpose.
They were this fucking close to doing it. And if they had just included the Vulture, and they could have, like, there's still that unresolved arc. And, you know, now that's gone anyway for the time being, because he's not, doesn't fucking remember him. But I loved that taxi scene in Homecoming with Keaton.
Oh yeah,
and Holland. Like, go show my daughter a good time, not too good a time. Now what do you say? Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Like, do you remember the meme?
No.
The Batman meme.
Uh-uh.
he's threatening Peter in the cab and telling him they should watch out for him. Peter's like, why? And he just holds up a picture of him as Batman.
That's great.
Like we mentioned earlier, Tony Stark is really like the Uncle Ben for all intents and purposes. Yep. You know, I really love that he played it aloof, but he wasn't really. Like, he even knew about the fucking churro that the lady bought him. And he was always keeping tabs on him. He always felt responsible for him.
He has a piece of, at that point, technically the spider suit that Peter was wearing in Homecoming was a piece of Stark tech, technically.
Yeah.
So if something like that, if something happens to that kid, I mean, even for Tony to cover his own ass, you know, it's like, I'm sure the name Stark is somewhere on that suit.
Yeah, because Ned had to, like, hack into it and turn off the training wheels protocol, dude.
Seriously? Training wheel protocol.
I'm ready. I fought Captain America. I'm ready. With the Vulture, I thought it was really interesting writing that he didn't reveal his identity in jail. Why do you think he kind of kept that honorable side of him? Why do you think he's keeping it close to the chest and isn't like blurting it out? Do you think maybe it's because of his daughter?
Maybe. I mean, I don't know how much, if I was in jail, how much I want people to know about me. I don't know. I don't know. I like how there was a callback though. Like, he got his tech by harvesting Chitauri tech. And then who was it? I don't think it's a throwaway part, but we also get the Shocker.
Yeah, I don't think it's throwaway either, but it's what it needed to be.
Yeah.
It's fine. I was fine with the Shocker being that role and it not being too much bigger.
Because it's a great movie.
It's a real good movie.
And we get all the way to Tom Holland and we're like, well, we've talked about so much. It's just like, well.
We get Aaron Davis.
Aaron Davis.
We get, quote unquote, who might be Prowler.
Oh, yeah.
Which means there might be Miles Morales.
Yeah. That is my ultimate. That's what I'm guessing right now, Billy, because Marvel has signed up to do 3 more Spider-Man movies with Sony. And I guarantee you before the end of those 3 movies, we're getting Miles.
Now, do you think they're going to abandon Prowler?
No.
You think we're still going to get him? Because he also makes the quote of, there's this crazy guy I used to work for, which could be Kingpin. Mm. And have you seen Hawkeye?
I have.
I haven't seen it, but I know that Kingpin is in it.
Mm-hmm.
So Kingpin is now officially part of the MCU, just like Daredevil is. Mm. Charlie Cox's Daredevil. And that leads us into the Spider-Verse movie where Prowler is working for Kingpin.
I can't say anything, Billy. If you haven't seen Hawkeye, I can't say shit.
No, say it. I'll watch it eventually, but I don't care about that the spoilers of that. Like,
that the Kingpin in Hawkeye?
Yeah.
That ain't fucking Daredevil's Kingpin. There's no fucking way.
Is it not the same actor?
It's the same actor. Dude, I will be convinced that's a fucking Skrull before I'm convinced that was the real Wilson Fisk.
Ooh, that
he is
okay.
Walmart bargain bin fucking Wilson Fisk. he has a pretty good fisticuff scene against Kate Bishop. There's no fucking way. Like, no way. So now could that Matt Murdock be Daredevil? Sure. That we get in No Way Home. Yeah, man, that could be cool because we saw him for like 3 seconds. The scenes that the Kingpin is in, you're like, no way. If this was their intent to showcase the Kingpin,
they either did a bad job
or that ain't the fucking Kingpin.
Well, in Far From Home, I knew the whole movie, something seemed off with Nick Fury. And I could not put my fucking finger on it. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, the very end stinger is that it's Talos.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh, shit. That makes so much sense. That writing was so smart.
Yep. Well,
and not only that, but Samuel L. Jackson played it beautifully.
Not quite Nick Fury.
Yep, not quite Nick Fury.
Then they brought that up in No Way Home. It's just like, Nick Fury's been off-world for over a year. What? Because that's the other thing we forget about No Way Home. I mean, it picks off at the end of Far From Home.
Very end. Like literal tail end.
So no time has passed in between Far From Home and No Way Home. And so when he says off planet for more than a year, that's like Peter can't comprehend that because Peter just saw the guy in Europe. Like, yesterday or whatever the hell.
Did you feel in Homecoming, the ferry scene, did you feel train scene remnants at all?
Kind of.
The struggle.
The crucifix pose.
Yeah.
Giving it his all, and then Papa Iron Man comes to the rescue.
If you really cared, you'd be here. I am here.
Ooh.
Who do you think called the feds?
Oh, man.
Watching out for you, Spidey boy.
Give me the suit back.
Give me the suit. I don't have any other clothes. We'll sort that out.
I hurt New York.
The next time we see Spider-Man, oddly, you know, if you go down the list, because it seems like it would, as we talk about it, it would naturally just be Homecoming, Far From Home.
Yeah.
But we get the huge Marvel event of Infinity War and Endgame between Spider-Man's 1 and 2 for Tom Holland.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't have a lot to say with Infinity War and Endgame because, you know.
Because everyone had their 10 minutes on screen or whatever.
Yeah. So good for podcasting, but, you know, bad for that. But I think the best part of Infinity War is when he was dubbed an Avenger. Stark just fucking goes, all right, kid, you're in space. You're an Avenger. Now, almost like going to space is like the requisite.
Yeah.
For becoming an
Avenger. He gets the Iron Spider.
Yeah.
Costume.
Yeah, that's really cool. I love the Iron Spider suit because it's one of the most iconic comic book suits too. That's what he wore in Civil War.
Yeah. You ever seen this really old movie Aliens? Oh, we're using our made up names. I'm Spider-Man then. My favorite scene. I don't know how they do
You're from Earth.
Yeah, I'm from Missouri. Yeah, that's on Earth, dipshit.
No offense, but I'm half human, so that 50% of me that's stupid is 100% of you.
Your math is blowing my mind right now. My favorite scene, you go back and rewatch it, is when Star-Lord is, not my favorite scene out of Infinity War, because there's a million scenes, but Star-Lord has got Spider-Man in a chokehold with a gun to his head. It's just kind of looking around. I don't know what it is. It's just that his eyes is just like, and he goes, you're not with Thanos? No, I want to kill Thanos. Wait, who are you guys this fast? We're the Avengers, man.
We're the fucking Avengers. Who are you?
I'll ask you this one time.
Yeah, let me ask
what you. What master do you serve?
What am I supposed to say, Jesus?
Thanos calling Spider-Man an insect. Straight out of the comics for others you don't know.
Oh, so it was those straight comic line?
Yep.
Oh, that's
grabbed him in midair, son, insect, throws him.
Love it.
Trying to think of all the, oh, I don't know. Of course, the coup de grace, I don't want to go.
Oh, man. I don't want to go. I don't want to go. It took so long for Tom Holland to live that down, man.
Mm-hmm. Do you know that his direction for that shot is one of the Coen brothers, right?
Russo.
Yeah. Jesus, I'm sorry. One of the Russo brothers say, just keep saying in your head how much you don't want to go. And so that just kind of came out of his mouth when he hugged Tony or hugged RDJ. I don't want to go. Don't give me the pouty lip, Billy. It's a sad scene. And the next time we see Spider-Man, as he's whipping through a portal back on Earth.
Dude, how fucking cool and emotional. I just rewatched it this morning.
Endgame.
Well, not the whole thing, just the scene.
That's a good scene.
Just the scene. Do you recall the cheering?
Yeah, dude, I live that day every day. It's how I get through my life.
Let me come at it another way. Is there another portal reveal that you cared about more or juiced you up more?
Oh, then Spidey. Howard the Duck. No. What was a good one? Honestly, I think a better show up moment was Thor in Infinity War landing, because it gives you hope. You're like, oh my God, they're going to pull this shit off. Because remember back in Infinity War, there's like, they're not really going to snap half of the heroes out of existence, are they? Are they? And so Thor showing up on Earth to help the Avengers on Earth kind of was a bigger like, oh my God, he made it. But everyone coming through the portal, like, I can't think of anyone got a better reaction than Spidey showing up. You know, I was excited to see everybody.
It was the biggest for sure.
Yeah. I mean, people were excited to see Drax and Star-Lord come through there. And Doctor Strange, because there's a million Doctor Strange fans out there, but yeah, Spidey coming through, and which is the whole premise of Tony changing his mind on the theory of time travel and trying to figure it out is Spider-Man, Peter Parker,
to bring him back.
Yeah, and so and there
he lost the kid. He wanted to find him again, man.
He did, oh my God.
Which unfortunately brings me to him saying goodbye to Tony.
Oh my God, we've done it.
And for those of you that have not seen it, we did a whole roundtable on this very movie, Avengers Endgame, Nerd Herd Podcast. Again, go to lionsdenmedia.com. Go subscribe to our YouTube and give it a listen. Get a free download on the website.
Yeah.
We went real hard. I did like 12 hours of Endgame this day. I watched it once in IMAX and then and then once in like regular digital with who was going to be on the show, and then did another like X hour podcast about it. So it was, I was real nerded out by the time we were done, but yeah, go check it out. But man, the ending, the saying goodbye to him, even at the funeral, I really love, I mean, the whole funeral shot is beautiful. Yep. Right. But when they just focusing on the Peter, the part with Peter in it,
yeah.
You know, Aunt May is behind him.
Yeah.
And she's trying to be as comforting as she can be, but it's almost like he wants no part of it. He's just kind of standing there. He has his chin up. He's looking straight, and you can tell he's emotional, but he's not bawling or anything like that. He's just like, I'm a man now. I just went through this literal war.
Yeah.
I lost the person that was my father figure. Like, I'm going to stand tall for him. How did you feel with the goodbye scene in the funeral? What goes through your mind even today, man?
My goodbye scene when, you know, Peter's goodbye to Tony, man, I'm like, oh, you bastard. Like, I'm like, you did it. And then you hear Peter keeping together best he can. We did it, Mr. Stark. You did it. And so we won. And then on to the funeral scene itself. You're right, though. Peter's sitting there standing strong. He's not weeping. He's just sitting there staring at the little rat that says, prove that Tony Stark has a heart. It is really sad. I don't like sad stuff. But yeah, it's huge. I mean, that literally is the arc going into Far From Home.
Yeah, Far From Home, right into him dealing with the loss of Tony and how to live up to his memory.
Yep.
You know, everyone thinks he's going to be the new Iron Man, and that's just not his path. Mm-mm. But man, Far From Home, did you think we were going to get Bubblehead Mysterio, dude?
No.
Oh my God. And they put it right there. The very first, you know, opening shots of the movie, we got fucking Bubblehead Mysterio, dude.
We get Bubblehead Mysterio, which is again, something that people have wanted to see. I don't know why. I don't know why Bubblehead. First off, it was more like, can y'all pull it off? You know, can you pull off Bubblehead
Mysterio? Right. And they made it kind of like Stark tech-ish, like nanotech. And that was super smart. It was really well done.
They did the clever backstory about being from another dimension.
Now, okay, here's my question.
Oh.
Do you prefer how they did it? Like, he's actually from this dimension, but he's a Stark employee and he's bad.
Uh-huh.
Or would have preferred the, I'm actually from an alternate dimension, and because I lost my world, I'm now a good guy?
I would have preferred another dimension Mysterio, but in his dimension, he fails to get Peter's glasses from Tony. Does that make sense?
Yeah, so he's trying again.
Yeah, he's trying it again, and he keeps doing it until he succeeds. And I think in this one, the reason he dies is because he actually fulfills it, and his fate or his destiny is like he realizes it too late that he keeps doing what he's doing. He dies for trying to get him. Or he succeeds in obtaining these glasses, and then he dies. But I'm okay with the way they did it as well. It makes sense that a guy that is pretty vindictive towards Tony would come up and haunt Peter Parker. It's good for the growth of Peter and Spider-Man as a character that it's like, because I'm Tony's boy, I'm going to have assholes seeking me out now, knowing that I have the key to all this technology and not really.
And he's
well.
Still only like 16.
Yeah. Like, that is that you want to talk about a plot hole? Come on, Tony. There's no one you'd rather trust a weapon.
They try to fill it, but dude, with the talk with Happy, but yeah, it's
come on. That I think that is, in my opinion, is a weak plot point. It's like
I would agree.
Tony feels like giving the key to this ultimate weapon to a high schooler is the best thing to do. Come on, man.
I will say they did a really good job of grounding all the blip stuff. And dude, the fucking tribute video that opened the movie.
Oh my God.
And I will always love you.
It's like all this shady, all like this distorted, like I don't know where the hell they got a picture of Black Widow, but and like the vision,
it's all like it's all
grainy
like
photos,
Google search images and shit, dude. It's so hilarious.
But so they're trying to be like, it's funny because they're trying to be so like sympathetic, and you just tell it's like, yeah, that's something a high schooler would call together. I want the most sappy song in the world, Whitney Houston. I will always love you. And I.
Can you explain something to me, though?
Uh-oh.
With the blip. So the kids that didn't blip are 5 years older.
Yep.
Okay. Why are they still
in high school?
Why are all the same? Why are blip kids and non-blip kids still together? I don't understand
that. They explain that kind of. They explained it in that movie in Far From Home that even though these guys have gone through and taken their tests, the blip mandate, if you will, says they have to go back, and take everything again. I don't know why. I don't know the reasoning behind it.
Okay. Yeah.
They like, it's a little throwaway line or whatever.
I do remember that line now.
And so, I mean, you could go back if you rewatch that scene. I mean, maybe you could pull something a little bit deeper out of it than I did, but I'm just like, I mean, it was a really quick, this is why these kids are still in high school type thing. So, I mean, who knows? And who knows how long people stayed out of education after the snap? You know, nobody knew how to do anything. That's a whole, we could go down that rabbit hole for Endgame. It's like there's a whole bunch of theories where Earth would have died because if it's all living things, they included plants and animals, which according to the comics, that was yes. When Thanos snapped his fingers, all living life, half of it. And Earth wouldn't have made it if half of its living organisms disappeared. Anyway, that's a different topic.
So I didn't know about the Ned character is supposed to be the Hobgoblin.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Until I did research after Far From Home.
I think that's going to be, if they do it.
I loved that, you know, again, rewatching, I love that he gets together with Betty like he's supposed to.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's a really cool nod.
Yeah.
That was really cute. That relationship is like every nerd's dream of, you know, the fat nerd impresses the cool chick by playing video games or whatever the fuck. And,
nice.
You know, she thinks it's cute that you get all like passionate about it. Like that's every nerd's dream.
That's
man.
My girlfriend, by the way.
That is your girlfriend. You're one of the rare fucking asshole.
She thinks it's cute that I'm passionate about my nerd shit.
Yep.
I was like, hey, I got to go do this podcast with Billy, and she's like, oh, what's going on? I was like, nerd shit. She's like, oh, okay, you have fun with Billy.
Thank you for letting John come play with me. Just a couple like funny moments of the flick of like, you know, I think it was Mysterio that asked what he could do. He's like, I'm strong and I'm sticky. And like Nick Fury is trying to recruit him, and he's like, I don't think I should, like, because he's 16.
Yeah.
And he goes, bitch, please, you've been to space. I love that line, dude.
Bitch, please, you've been to space.
Do you feel Nick Fury's absence in any of these movies? Because, yeah, like, it was technically Talos, but...
Yes.
You know what I mean? Like, do you feel like any of these Marvel movies that don't have much or any Nick Fury, like, needs Nick Fury? Like, do you think every Marvel movie should have a little fucking something of Nick Fury in it?
Okay, well, you say any. Does Nick Fury belong in Guardians anywhere? No.
Well, fucking he's in space now.
Now he is, all right? Does he really belong in, like, a Thor movie? No.
Again, he was in fucking Thor, too.
When was he in Thor?
Was he not in Thor?
Wasn't in Thor.
Well, his presence of
You're
being
fucking Thor. Me right now, Billy. He was in Thor.
I thought he was, because Coulson was there, and weren't they like talking?
Coulson was.
Weren't they like talking on the phone and stuff?
Maybe, but he wasn't there. I don't think he was on the phone. He might have said, "Yes, sir, I'm checking it out now," or whatever. That may have been Nick Fury.
So for you, it doesn't impact it as much.
I mean,
that's fine. It doesn't have to impact it. It's just a question.
I'm trying to think of another like a street level Marvel thing. I think there should be a reason why Hawkeye should have reached out to him.
That's interesting.
You know, in the Hawkeye series, but I'm not going to tell you what may or may not have happened. Oh, yeah, I've already told it. Yeah, but he doesn't. You know, I'm like, if there's any one thing where Nick Fury should be showing up in, it would be like a street-level S.H.I.E.L.D. agent thing, you know? And he never shows up in Hawkeye. But, again, if it's not really Nick Fury, and if there's no way for Barton to get a hold of anyone, I don't know. See, that is something where I do feel like he's missed. Somebody assisting Hawkeye with some, like... And again, the whole premise of Hawkeye is somebody steals, or the Ronin pops up again, you know, and the Ronin is an assassin that killed people for 5 years when everybody was snapped. And it just seems like that at some point that would have shown up on S.H.I.E.L.D.'s radar, and anytime S.H.I.E.L.D.'s involved and then Nick Fury knows everything and he knows that that's Barton somehow, why the fuck doesn't he show up and find Barton? I don't know. So there you go. So to answer this incredibly long answer to your question, I think in some of the shows, Nick Fury
should have more Nick Fury in it.
Yeah, or just pop up, you know?
I really loved in Far From Home the expansion of MJ, of this MJ character, because yes. In Homecoming, I wasn't really that big of a fan of her. She didn't have much to do, mm-hmm. but they really fleshed her out in Far From Home and really made her a likable character. And, you know, them getting together was so, so cute and innocent. You know, they had the little, like, you know, the little like pecs and stuff. It wasn't like the standard superhero fucking like,
we got that in No Way Home, buddy. We got the long drawn out kisses in the No Way Home.
What's your take on this MJ, man? Do you like her?
Do I like her? Yes. What is her real name? Mary
Michelle Jones.
Michelle Jones. Michelle Jones.
Watson.
Watson.
Still Watson.
Yep. So Michelle Jones. I like her. I like now you want to talk about like Peter's growth, you know, MJ's growth throughout these movies. She is the incredibly in Homecoming, she's incredibly like walled up. She doesn't let anyone know anything. And she slowly starts to creep out of her shell in Far From Home. And then No Way Home, she lets her guard down and, you know, because she cares. You know, she shows that she cares what happens to her friends. Like, even when it comes down to, like, the acceptance letters to get into college. You know, she's showing that, yeah, it sucks, but it sucks. And I know it sucks, and I'm sorry. You know what I'm saying? So I like the character arc of this, of our current MJ played by Miss Zendaya.
Zendaya is great, man. And I didn't know they were together until before I saw No Way Home.
Oh, that's sweet.
I guess everyone shits on them because of the height difference. And they're just like, fuck you.
What height difference? Is she taller than him? I don't know things.
Oh, you're being...
I'm dead fucking serious.
Yeah, dude. They don't force any of that. Like, she's just...
That's sweet.
Way taller.
Good taller.
So why wasn't Peter's spider sense working in Far From Home? Because he couldn't pick up on where Mysterio was.
Okay, when does that take place? Like, because the thing is... Because he says in, we got to back up, to Civil War, he said he had his powers for 6 months before Civil War. It was like 3 or 6 months. He says that. And then we fast forward from there. It's like 6 months have passed. So it's been a year since he's been bitten by a spider. Maybe he just hasn't. Like the first time we see it, the tingle is Infinity War. The hairs on his arm stand up.
It's true.
And so I think he just starts to get it. I think it's one of those.
Okay, so they're like slowly developing it, but they're not explaining that they're slowly developing it. Yeah. It's just something we're having to pick up. All right. I mean, that's fine. I just remember I was watching it, like, why isn't he figuring this out that these things are threats right away? Like his Peter Tingle isn't working the way it should. I mean, they say as much.
Use your tingle.
Aunt May's all fucking like, oh, is your Peter Tingle not working or whatever the fuck it says.
Your Peter Tingle.
The mocap suit from Mysterio is like a nod to CG artists. That was really cool.
That was awesome. Peter Billingsley was in there. Man.
Oh, yeah. I forgot they brought Billingsley back.
Yep.
Because they connected everything from the first Iron Man.
Yeah, I think what had happened was that Tony Stark was the original Black Bart from A Christmas Story. And Ralphie has grown up searching for Black Bart. He's finally got his Red Ryder BB gun just sitting above his mantle at his house. That's my theory. That's my theory, Billy.
That's what we need. We need an MCU Christmas Story crossover. We need to share those IPs and we need to get this going, Marvel. Let's fucking go.
It's what the people want. And by people, I mean me and Billy. Have I said fuck you, Danny Elfman, in the last 20 minutes? Because I really need to say it like 3 or 4 more times.
Go for it, rapid fire.
Fuck you, Danny Elfman, for screwing up the Avengers theme in Avengers Age of Ultron. It was your fault that movie wasn't as good.
So we are almost to No Way Home. We're almost there.
Oh,
I'm sure I'm going to cut this into parts. It's fine.
Well, that's good.
There's a couple last things I want to talk about No Way Home that are kind of important to Peter's development. And one of those things is his relationship with Happy.
Yeah.
On the plane. I want to make sure I don't miss anything. You know, one of the most important lines, he's stitching him up and he's like, ow, ow, ow. And Happy goes, I thought you had super strength. And he just, it still hurts. And you know, that while it's a funny line, it really opens up a whole other idea of just because this guy's a fucking superhero doesn't mean shit doesn't affect him.
Yeah.
Like everything he's going through is making him hurt. And you know, yeah, on the funnier side, he got hit with a train, dude. Like, that's still going to hurt. But just the other existential of, like, you know, I might have superpowers, but that doesn't mean I don't have feelings.
Yeah.
Like, that really got me a lot.
Also, Happy saying no one is going to be Tony Stark. It's like, there's only one Tony.
Yeah.
And, like, so stop trying.
You know? Be you kind of thing. Yeah. And just the closure, that scene gave them both closure of Tony being gone when Peter was making a suit, even like, especially when he did the fucking, like, the thing into the hologram and, and, you know, Favreau looking, even though he wasn't even in that scene, you know, Happy wasn't in that scene when Tony was building his first Iron Man suit.
He was behind
suits.
The camera.
Yeah, but you know what I mean?
He was behind the camera, like, when that happened.
But seeing him do that, and even us as fans, we were just like, fuck, yes.
Yeah.
Yes, bitch. And and then the music, he's like, you handle the build, I'll handle the music. He puts on AC/DC. He's like, oh, I love Led Zeppelin. No, kid. No. And somehow in the third act of this fucking movie, the climax of this Spider-Man movie, they made fighting drones look interesting.
Yeah.
I don't know how they pulled it off, but somehow they made it look dynamic and just fun. Did you enjoy that? Like, do you agree? Or
I agree. Like,
any idea like how they pulled that off with us? Because I have no idea how
Well, you had your... They weren't pushover drones. I guess that's the thing. They were drones that could shoot you and still, like, instead of just being holographic drones, there were holographic drones that were loaded with missiles and machine guns and yeah. So I think that's how they made it like seem like a viable threat. And then how they were still able to do, like, when Spider-Man's going down the corridor trying to get Mysterio and the drones are in there still doing holographic shit. You know what I'm saying? Anyway, yes, I bought into the drones being bad guys.
It's so weird. You know, amazing, just weird. So, I think that's about all I got leading up to No Way Home.
I think we're, yeah.
You feel primed?
Oh, boy.
Feel ready?
I hope.
You want to take a quick break?
Let's take a quick break.
Let's take a quick break.
Fuck you, Danny Elfman.
Back, man. We are ready to dive into Spider-Man No Way Home finally. I'm sure many of you tuned in to get right to this, but I did not think it was fair to only talk about this movie without talking about the entire Spider-Verse in its entirety, man. I really wanted to make this a big event. And before we get hardcore going, I want to show you guys these Tom Holland suit pictures and videos. It was so cool seeing the Tom Holland suit.
Oh, yeah?
In person, man. It has so much detail in it. Look at that.
That's pretty cool.
Like, that's what he wore on set. I mean, I feel bad for him. It was probably terrible to actually wear. But just the amount of detail when they could have just put him in, like, a skin-tight green suit and just animated it.
Yeah.
I love that they're dipping more and more into practical stuff these days. Yeah, even doing the fucking web shooters there.
Yeah, you're right. The actually wearing it practicality is probably not all there. I'm sure he's like, all right, let's take 3 hours to get this suit on.
And like no way to pee or anything either. It's, yeah. You know, but
I'm sure that suit has seen some messes.
And apparently they pull the eyes out so he can drink. Yeah. Have you seen that? But this was such a cool display. And this was like, right. I don't think Far From Home had come out yet. So this was it.
Nice. Spider suit.
Does whatever a spider suit does, except letting you pee.
Which that's the spider suit superpower. You don't have to pee or poop while you're inside of it.
But super cool stuff, man. All right, so we already got the negative stuff out of the way earlier in the show. I cannot remember a movie experience this incredible. I can't remember a movie that had so much applause throughout the entire movie. What was your viewing experience like, man?
There was a lot of clapping, a lot of like gasps, you know, a lot of, oh, wow. You know, that, I mean, you just heard it, you know, surrounded by strangers. Even my brother who was sitting next to me was like, that's cool. You know, he's very reserved when it comes to his emotions whilst watching a movie. And he was, we were just all taken back, man. We're looking at, again, of course, the big reveals of Tom and Andrew. I think we've talked about that already.
Well, what made you cheer the most?
Made me cheer the most? It was the scene where all three Spider-Men are like in sync and they're swinging around each other. They're thwipping when they need to thwip. They're dodging when they need to dodge. They're communicating. So I think that was it. You know, the landing on the roof of the Statue of Liberty.
Yeah,
they
dude.
Get their pose.
The pose, the tri-pose, dude, that is so epic. I can't wait for there to be like a high-res version of that.
Dude, there is so many little points in this movie that are like, dude, this is great. This is awesome. Again, I think our con list was about one or two things a piece. And,
dude, I remember when
the rest of it was just great.
I remember when Toby popped out, and you know, that was another big cheering point, obviously.
Yeah.
And I remember yelling. I was a little too vocal, maybe, in this movie. A lot of like, yes, bitches, you know, throughout the whole thing.
Yes,
but,
bitches.
When Toby popped up on the scene, I was just like, and he doesn't look 12.
He doesn't look 12. He doesn't look 12 at all. The out of all the Peter Parkers and Spider-Man, he definitely looked the eldest.
I want to say my biggest cheers revolved around Garfield, because again, he's been my favorite Spider-Man. Mm-hmm. And especially with Gwen, I you know, I've said it throughout the whole show, I love the Gwen Peter Parker dynamic.
Yeah.
As much as I love Gwen and MJ, I think I cheered the most. There were two times, one for each pass, Spidey. I'll give one each. There was when Garfield saved Gwen.
Yeah.
And
or MJ.
MJ. Uh-huh. Thank you. Mm-hmm. See, I have it.
Yep.
I have it in my head. Yep. I have it in my head, dude. You know, that really validated, or not validated, but it gave him closure.
Yeah.
Because he failed Gwen, and being able to save MJ in the same fashion and learning from his mistakes and, you know, going on this ride with him. And we see, like, throughout the whole movie, he's just like, he's grunged down, he's bittered, and
yeah,
you know, this has been plaguing him for years and years and years, and he finally gets his chance and he takes it and he succeeds. And fuck, dude, I was driving to work that next day, and I was thinking about that scene, and I was crying.
No,
just super misty eyed thinking about that
big
scene.
Old softy.
But the other one for Toby, it was a little quick thing, and I'm sure there's a bunch of them that made me cheer there for sure. But I feel like I was one of the only people that caught this when Doc Ock is cured.
Yeah.
And he recognizes Peter. He's like, Peter, my boy.
Yeah.
How have you been? And he goes, he thinks for a minute. He goes, trying to do better.
Aww.
That was, dude, just taking it right back. They wrote this fucking movie so well.
Yep.
Every reveal, every drop, just in general, the whole movie was a pleasure to watch. It was 2.5 hours, went by like that.
Yep.
But everything was so well balanced, and they managed to wrap up like anything you didn't like about the first two franchises.
Mm-hmm.
They made sure you're going to like from now on.
Yeah. They did. They wrapped it up. They, I think they put a bow on the first two franchises, like you just mentioned. I think, yeah, because what sucks about the first two franchises, we never got our finish. You know, we never really got our ending. You know, there was plans for a Spider-Man 4. There was plans for an Amazing Spider-Man 3. And so, like, the news just kind of came down the pipe to both Toby and Andrew, like, hey, we're done. Without any kind of send-off, without anything. And I think this movie offers that to them. This movie offers up, hey, man, we appreciate what you did. You are not forgotten. You guys were Spider-Man before Tom. You guys were Spider-Man before the MCU, well, technically not
Andrew Garfield, but you guys were, you guys are and were, or were and are Spider-Man, so thank you very much. And so they get their, they all got their closure, they all get to go home, and that's that. I don't think, and I really, I don't believe we're going to see them again in the MCU, in my opinion. I don't think it's going to happen again.
No, I'm sure this was a one-time event.
Yep.
And you know, we're done with it. I want to talk about Ned because, again, I didn't know that character was supposed to be Hobgoblin. Mm-hmm. I just thought Ned was just a random written friend.
Yeah.
And now Ned is magical.
Ooh.
And did you catch the costume tease?
Nope. Oh, the cape on him? Or no?
No, so when he's at his Lola's house, there's a real quick shot of a sewing machine, and there's a green, almost like oriental-looking top.
No.
Like Wong-ish.
I didn't catch it.
I was hoping maybe you had, because I'm not sure whose costume that's supposed to be.
I think I was in the middle of freaking out in that whole scene. So
sure.
The only kind of, you know, foreboding I got was the Cape of Levitation. Okay. Snagged Ned and like levitated him down. You know what I'm saying? So,
because the cape has to choose you.
Yeah. So
we're fucking Harry Potter.
Yeah.
So after realizing, after I saw the movie, that he's maybe not destined, but that he has Hobgoblin roots from the books, you know, I started to contemplate, do you remember the scene when the Death Star breaks?
Yeah.
I thought that was just a fun callback because it had broken like once or twice before. Now, I think maybe that was a foreshadowing of their friendship crumbling.
No.
Well, come on. They even do the scene of like how the other two Spider-Men are talking about how their best friends like betrayed them or some shit.
And he promises he won't.
And he promises he won't.
All right.
And now, you know, he doesn't remember Peter. He's basically, as far as he's concerned, doesn't have a best friend. Maybe him and MJ are friends, but he doesn't have Peter as a best friend anymore.
Right. Oh my God, stop. You're blowing my fucking mind, Billy.
So it's very, very plausible that we're going to get him as some version of Hobgoblin, but is it going to be magic Hobgoblin? Like if anyone has any idea of what that costume was, because that's really like bugging me, is what that tease was for, because it looked very Wong-ish, and Wong is Sorcerer Supreme now, and he's mad, and you know, Ned's magic now. So if anyone has any cool theories or any answers, like, pop them in the comments, man. I would love to hear them. What do you want to happen with Ned?
I want him to stay besties. I want them to become besties again. I think the Ed-Peter dynamic was great.
Well, yeah, like the whole Etch-a-Sketch mechanic of the memory loss, but obviously they'll get their memories back maybe at some point, or will we? Maybe they'll keep Ned embittered. Maybe Spider-Man will do something to Ned that is unintentional, but that causes the feud.
Yep. Maybe. Yeah. Maybe Peter saves Ned in some kind of fashion and it goes sideways, you know?
Now, do you think Ned remembers that he's magic?
Yeah. I think it's just the Peter Parker thing.
Okay. It's not like a web of,
it's not like a web of treats, or what are you talking about over there? A web of lies.
You know what I mean? Like Peter Parker knowing he's Spider-Man or not, they don't know who he is at all. So that, I would think that would, you know, I'm not going to say web again. That wouldn't branch.
What kind of branch? Like a web branch? Like a branch that's got some spider webs on it? What you talking about, Billy?
Oh, man.
Sorry, buddy.
I don't know. I feel like that kind of shit splinters off from not knowing Peter. And I, you know, we'll eventually find out, but I don't know. That seems like it would be weird that he would remember that he's magic. But, I mean, they don't, right? Because she doesn't, MJ doesn't know how she got hurt.
I don't know either.
They don't remember anything from the adventure. So how would he know he's magic? So
I don't know.
Maybe they're just going to retcon it completely. Like, all right, Ned was magic in this movie and then never again.
No, they can't do that.
I wouldn't think they would. Like,
or check this out, Billy.
What you got?
Oh, boy. Now, we all know that the post-credits trailer is the Multiverse of Madness trailer.
Right.
Okay. Follow me here. I'm thinking we're going to get some Baron Mordo and Ned Leeds in the very near future.
Well, he's in the movie.
And that's what I'm saying. What, Baron Mordo?
Yeah. Wasn't he in the movie?
No. And he's going to be in the Multiverse of Madness.
Right. That's what I mean.
But yeah. I'm thinking we're going to get that bad guy, Baron Mordo, is going to link up with Ned Leeds
at
some point. And he's going to be a bad sorcerer. I think he's going to be nasty.
Looks like, you know, we've all had that. We've all wondered, like, well, what the fuck happened with Mordo? It's been...
Jesus, it's been forever. When did Doctor Strange come out? It feels like it came out at least 12 years ago.
It's been a hot minute, man.
We're missing a Doctor Strange movie. Like, yeah. I mean, it's like we got Doctor Strange, and then he popped up in Thor Ragnarok, and then he was in the Infinity Wars and in games.
When did he pop up in Ragnarok?
He was the guy that knew where Odin was.
Oh, you're talking about Strange. I don't know. I brain farted and thought you were talking about Mordo. Like, oh, the fuck did he pop up then? Yeah, you're right.
Oh, Billy.
Sorry.
Billy. You never listen to me, Billy.
I want to talk about some of these hits, man. Like,
get the hits.
These are, man, I love this fucking movie so much. I swear I'm just fat because of how much I love the movie, not because I'm just bursting with awesomeness, not, you know, butter. You know, the first Garfield through the portal, that was, I think, one of the first big applauses.
Yep.
Because you're not quite sure at first, but all of a sudden you make them out. And that's another thing. I, you know, with all the Spider-Men working together, that was really cool. Like when they're like sciencing together. Yep. And even afterwards, and they're like web slinging, I thought it was going to be really hard to tell them apart.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's at night. All the suits are basically the same,
yeah.
Especially Garfield's and Toby's. But it wasn't. Like, I never really lost who was who. Did you?
Nope, I didn't. I knew what was going on pretty handedly. Have we talked enough about the Matt Murdock?
We haven't talked about it at all, really. We just mentioned that he was there. Were you dissatisfied that there was no Daredevil at the end? Because I was kind of hoping there would be, but I wasn't like upset that there wasn't.
I'm not heartbroken that we didn't get Daredevil.
Because it was about Spider-Man. It was about the Spider-Man. It wasn't about Daredevil.
Matt Murdock grabbing that brick mid-flight at the same time that Peter's trying to grab the brick mid-flight. That's all I needed.
That was really cool.
That's all I needed.
How did you do that?
I'm a really good lawyer.
I'm just glad they fucking gave the respect to Charlie Cox, man.
Yeah.
The Daredevil was a really great show, and it sucks the MCU shows weren't better, and they got canceled on Netflix.
Yeah, well, that's because Disney wants their properties on Disney Plus. So,
yeah.
Which is fine. I'm sure they're working up some more stuff. I mean, I think Hawkeye was the last show that was slated, right? Oh, no, never mind. We have like She-Hulk is it? Moon Knight is coming. She-Hulk is coming.
So Moon Knight's a show?
Yeah.
Okay.
Moon Knight's a show. She-Hulk is a show. And I know I'm missing something. Oh, Loki 2.
Yeah.
Wow! I got the heart.
Well, I mean, the Loki show was fine for like a watch to know what was going on. Mm-hmm. It had some cool stuff in it, but bring that into a feature somewhere.
Yeah, you're
right. Which, I mean, they kind of did, like...
You're right. Ask me if, hey, John, have you gone back and rewatched any of the shows after you've watched them one time? Nope.
I almost want to go back and watch WandaVision again.
Yeah, because that's got probably the most stuff in it.
Yeah. I loved, again, Willem Dafoe making his round in this movie and actually getting to act. They did the purple hood, dude. They gave us purple hooded Hobgoblin, man. How fucking cool was that?
That was pretty badass.
They, as soon as they could, they destroyed this mask. Like the very next scene he was in,
yep,
they had him destroy this fucking thing. And don't get me wrong, this mask is beautiful. It's great looking. I love it. It's iconic, but it really hinders the acting ability. And it, like you said, you had a great point. It takes away from Willem Dafoe.
And you don't need it.
I originally thought that maybe they would, again, like how kind of how they did with the bubble head, that maybe they do a Stark Tech kind of thing where it comes up. But I'm so glad they had him destroy it. Right. Again, that's another example of just really, really great writing.
Yep.
And I wonder if he had anything to do with that. If he was like, hey, I'll come back, but can we blow this fucking thing up already?
No, I think that came from, it's like, why the hell does he need it? And he's like, where did he have time to make it that damn mask? And I understand back in 2002, I'm sure he had all the time in the world, but it's like, why is he wearing that mask? He can't hide it anywhere, you know? And then I think the conversation, they cover it with a conversation that he's having with himself. And for Norman to break free of the goblin, he feels like he must break that mask, you know?
It's, you know, they give a reason for everything that happens in this flick, and it's not lost on me at all. Did you catch the Miles Morales tease?
The Jimmy Fox talk or Electro talking about there's got to be a black Spider-Man somewhere.
Right.
Yeah, I did. I guess.
Now, because I might be mistaken. I know he was like, I was hoping one of you'd be black or something akin to that. I thought Andrew Garfield was the one that said, there's got to be a black Spider-Man somewhere. But did Electro say that?
Did
someone said Electro said it. But
I thought it was Electro. I might be wrong.
I'm not sure who said there's got to be a black Spider-Man somewhere, but that's a definite Miles Morales tease. The question is, which universe is he in? Is he in this one with Toby, or is he in the
Tom?
With Tom.
Okay.
But I think it would have to be the one with Toby, because if we go back to Spider-Verse, even though it's not, I don't think it's the same Toby Spider-Man, but they show us a lot of the same scenes.
Mm-hmm.
They show us the train. They show us the MJ kiss, but it's reversed.
Yeah.
And the Hobgoblin there is the demon version. So there's some definite changes, but there's also real big similarities that makes you think it's the Raimi verse Spider-Man. So I think he's in the Toby verse, man.
I think it's in the Tom verse.
You think he's in Tom?
Yeah, I think, like I said, I think we're going to get a Miles Morales to replace Peter in the next three Spider-Man movies.
What do you mean? Like they're at college, so they befriend Miles Morales?
Or something. Or, again, maybe they graduate college, and he's out, and he's an adult now doing Spider-Man things, and Miles is his protege in like the second movie. Like, yeah, because we just did it in the first Tom Holland trilogy. So maybe even the first movie we meet Miles. Second, he becomes Spider-Man. He like becomes a fanboy in the first one, accidentally gets bit by a spider in the second one, becomes Peter's protege. And then the last one, you know, Tom Holland, you know, says goodbye and Miles Morales becomes the new Spider-Man. I just think because
that's as good as any theory anyone would have. I don't know, man. I think the memory loss will, because even at the end, that last shot of MJ where she was like, huh?
Well, yeah. Maybe she just thought it was cute.
Maybe. I think they'll eventually have to do away with the memory loss thing. just solely for the fans. But if Miles, if they do a live action Miles Morales, because I mean we get Spider Verse, Across the Spider Verse here soon,
yep.
Part One. So it's not like we're not getting more Miles, but yeah. As far as a live action one, I don't know. I don't think they're going to time hop that much. I think it's going to be they're in college now and they're all at MIT together, yeah. Kind of thing.
But I figure they're going to knock out these next three Tom Holland movies in the next 5 years.
So, okay. Tom Holland is signed on for three more movies, right? Because I've heard it yes. Both ways.
No, he is. They are on for three more Spider-Man movies. And I think it's a good thing because of the memory loss, because there's not going to be any more like, where's Spider-Man? Because no one really knows what's going on over there in New York. You know, it's just like, I think it's a good segue in the next few movies that we're getting. Multiverse of Madness. You don't really need Spider-Man in there.
No.
You're about to get, we're going to get Thor, Love and Thunder. You're not going to need a Spider-Man in that movie. You know, we're going to have enough time to not necessarily forget that Spider-Man's there, but I think the next Spider-Man movies we get is going to be Spider-Man Meets World. Is it a boy meets world? We're going to get Spider-Man Meets World. And I think, yeah, I think we're going to get a few villains pop up here and there. It's going to be Spider-Man level baddies. And we're going to get introduced to like Black Cat, Miles Morales, this version of Doc. Maybe somebody that hits a red flag for Peter. Like he recognizes a name. Like a Dr. Connors, and that's what they were calling the Lizard. You know?
Oh shit, bitch, that's good.
Yeah, you see what I'm saying?
That's a good angle. I love that.
And is that? And then they. But now here's what we haven't talked about yet. What else they are going to do in these next three movies? The mid credit scene. There's a little drop of symbiote.
The Venom. So I have a huge question about this.
Ooh.
that kind of got answered. A coworker that had seen the Carnage movie. Answered it for me. So it's kind of my fault for not seeing Carnage. But I mean, Sony make Venom good and we'll go see the movie. So that mid credit stinger, right? I was like, okay, I'm with it. I knew at the end of the Venom Carnage movie, He saw the news reel of Peter Parker's Spider-Man.
Yep.
So, okay, he's in that universe. Okay. So now cut to the No Way Home with Eddie Brock and mm-hmm. Venom. But then he goes back to his own quote-unquote universe. They show him dissipating back into it.
Yeah.
Okay. So he's not in that universe. Question one. Question two, how did he know Peter Parker was, because Brock didn't know, but Venom did know.
Ooh, I know.
So
I have my theory. You go ahead first.
So my thought process was, without seeing Carnage, okay. Mind you, without seeing Carnage, my thought process was, well, it's got to be Venom that knows and not Eddie. And if that's the case, then it has to be a multiverse consciousness. And I was talking about this at work, and my coworker was like, well, yeah, that's exactly what it is. They talk about that. Like, Venom says how all the symbiotes are a collective consciousness.
Yep.
And I was like, well, fuck. I guess I should see the movies more.
Yeah.
Is that what you had on tap?
Yeah. What is it? Extra-dimensional
collective consciousness, yeah. Whatever.
And so maybe in Venom's, or whatever, Tom Holland's universe, Peter Parker either doesn't exist, or has died earlier or whatever. So I'm thinking in, you know, that now they say that could be Miles Morales's universe,
the one that they're Venom showing Venom Morbius from.
Yeah.
Oh, is Morbius not in Tom Holland's either?
I don't think so.
Hopefully they'll give us something to tell us one way or the other.
There's no way that they don't tell us exactly where this dude is. I think if Morbius isn't, I think if they don't put some, I mean, we get Morbius referencing Venom in the trailer, but I think they're missing out if they don't somehow include both those guys in like some kind of scene, or if it's either Venom watching a newsreel on Morbius or vice versa, Morbius watching a newsreel on Venom, to that locks them in to, like, they are literally across the country from each other, but they inhabit the same world.
I'm just kind of confused as to why. So I guess the stinger, because the spell hadn't happened yet. So why is the Venom stinger that he's seeing the newsreel, but then he goes back to a different universe? Like, it's real fucking convoluted. I think they fucked up on the Venom stinger is just what it comes down to.
Maybe. I think.
Because the continuity doesn't make sense.
You're right, but neither does Green Goblin being alive and Doc Ock being alive when both of those guys are dead before we get Sandman.
Okay. Yeah, like there's definitely a time thing. You're right.
Yep.
My point is, though, that in the Venom movie, they show him in the universe before the spell happens.
Okay, yeah.
Because they show him when that first newsreel hits of Parker being revealed to be Spider-Man. Mm-hmm. Spell hadn't happened yet.
All right.
So why is he, if that's not his home universe, why is he there? How'd he get there?
I don't know, Billy.
You know what I mean? Wait,
this is what we're going to do. Email Disney really quick. Well, no, you have to email Sony and be like, excuse me.
Why'd you fuck up the stingers?
What the fuck? Sincerely. Billy from Philly.
Barry from Ferry. That was just one of my bigger questions.
It's a good question. It should be answered.
I love that. The additional Spider-Man wasn't just a quick gimmick. It wasn't just a quick, like, third act. Hey, we're here and we're doing stuff. It was an integral part of the story, and it was an integral part of Tom Holland's Peter Parker's development as a character.
Yep. You could say that they are supporting characters.
Like everything from the Uncle Ben stories after. Yep. Oh fuck, we gotta talk about Aunt May dying, dude.
I was hoping you forgot.
Oh man, right about that. Right in the fucking feels. And you don't think she's gonna die. You know, a lot of people might think once she starts with the gray power responsibility line that maybe that's when, because like if you say that line, you're basically gonna die. But even then, I was like, not quite. It was that first falter.
Yeah,
I was like, oh shit.
Yeah,
they're gonna kill her off, man. Take me through you watching that scene, dude. Come on,
I don't want to do this.
You gotta, man.
All right, I'm just gonna say
with great power comes great responsibility.
And with things that happen to Aunt May, it makes me sad. When bad things happen to Aunt May, that made me sad. But again, that was pseudo-spoiled for me too. When,
oh really? That sucks.
No, only because Tom Holland said in an interview, he's like, "This is a very emotional movie." It's like there was a day on set where everyone was crying, and I was just like, well, "When the fuck is that going to be?" And then the whole thing with the glider happened. I was like, now as soon as the glider levitated, I'm like, Aunt May's about to die.
Yeah. I did have this fear of like, oh my God, is who's getting fucking shish kebabbed?
Like I knew
who's getting goblin kebabbed.
I knew she stood up. I knew as soon as she stood up and just the way she was talking is like, she's hurt bad.
Well, yeah. Pumpkin bomb went off.
So right anyway, I'm just like, all right, this isn't good. So I don't know, man. I was able to compartmentalize. There it is.
Compartmentalize.
What was going to happen? Like, I guess, like really quick. It's like, oh, dude, she's about to die. I was like, oh, damn it. And that was, you know, Aunt May replaced the role of Uncle Ben in with our Tom Holland Spider-Man.
We almost thought we were going to get away with it. We almost thought we were going to get away without an emotional Uncle Ben. We had the Tony Stark thing, but that was slightly different.
Yep.
That was the end of the hero's journey for Tony more than it was an Uncle Ben death. Fuck, man. We were this close, and they were like, nah, bitch. we got you. I couldn't deal with it. And, you know, them knowing the Uncle Ben stories, and because he, you know, Tom Holland Spidey wanted no part of it.
Yep.
He didn't want to hear from anyone. He's like, you have no idea how I feel. And they're like, yeah, dude, we do. Yeah. Like, we know exactly how you feel. And they went as far as to tell the stories and finish the line. You know, no power or great power comes great responsibility, man.
There it is. That makes me sad. But that is Spider-Man's character, man. That's it. You got to have it.
Just sad.
It's sad. Marissa Tomei, you deserve better than the glider to the ribcage or wherever the hell I got you.
No, they pumpkin bombed her, right?
No, she got hit by the glider first. Oh, they pumpkin bombed. Yeah. Billy.
Why didn't he, like, fucking thwip the pumpkin bomb, dude?
Billy. I don't know.
Because they wanted us to cry?
Because they wanted us to boohoo a little bit, all right? Get the fuck out of here. I'm sick of your shit. We need to bring up another positive point right now.
Okay, well, we'll get to the end of that arc, which was Toby stopping Tom Holland.
Oh.
How powerful was that? He stopped him with a fucking look.
Yeah.
There was so much in that look. Not only should you not do this, but you are better than this. Your Aunt May would not want this. I know exactly what you're feeling, and this isn't what you want to do. Like, just in a fucking look.
Yeah. It had to be Toby.
It had to be. I think that was a great choice, not only because of the Green Goblin arc, but I think it was great to have, like, the old grizzled vet kind of coaching up the new rookie kind of thing. Yeah. Like, I've been through it, kid, and this is
you
the way.
You have no idea how bad you don't want to do this.
Yeah. Like, this is going to fuck you up a long time to come.
That was huge. Good stuff. All parties involved.
Yeah, but just the first to last Spider-Man, it was just super poetic.
Dude.
How about Toby being fucking Andrew Garfield's emotional support spider?
You're amazing.
Dude, you're amazing. Oh my God.
You're amazing.
Say it.
I'm amazing.
Say it. Say you're amazing.
I'm amazing. My lower back.
The back cracking, dude. That was so.
Want me to get you? Yeah, please.
Yeah, it's from web slinging. I got this mid lower back thing too. You want me to? Oh, dude.
My back.
Again, they took all the negative stuff from the last two trilogies or franchises, and made them positive. Like, no one liked Garfield's Peter Parker, and they rewrote him to be this fun, not like stuttering mess. Pretty mess, but still a mess. So we get to the end, and Doctor Strange is doing the big ribbon thing.
Ooh.
He's casting the spell. He's trying to close all the multiverses. Who did you pick out in those of the people that were trying to come through? I definitely saw a Rhino, like animated series Rhino. Did you see anyone specific in those silhouettes?
Maybe Kraven.
I thought I saw Kraven, but I don't remember Kraven having the staff.
But whatever. When I go back and rewatch, that is something I will check out on my rewatch of this movie. Because, again, I was more concerned with what the hell was going on in the movie. I wasn't looking for Easter eggs. I was watching for, you know, I was waiting to see, like, again, I was waiting for Venom to show up.
I think everyone wanted Venom, but...
Yeah, I think Venom was... I was waiting for Venom to show up, and he just never did, that asshole.
I think, again, we could take out Sandman in this movie and not miss him, and you could include Venom. Maybe not, like, hardcore include Venom, but you could... I don't think this movie needed Sandman.
Oh.
Because, think about it, Tom Holland had none of his own villains.
No, I disagree. I think Sandman being there to say, to confirm that, yes, Osborn and Doc Ock, you die at the hands of Spider-Man. Matter of fact, the only one who didn't die at the hands of Spider-Man was Sandman.
That's true.
So I don't know if Dr. Connors died. I don't remember.
Yeah, I don't think he died. No, because they showed him in the jail.
Okay.
He was in the jail at the end of ASM1.
So, but anyway, I know that, you know, Flint Marko was the guy that could be like, yeah, it was all over the papers. It's like Norman Osborn and Doc Ock die at the hands of Spider-Man.
All right. Like, fair enough. I guess that's fine. But he really didn't have a huge part in the movie except to do that, to be like,
yeah,
no, you guys died and I'm also a villain.
Yeah. Perfect.
That was his whole thing.
Perfect. But yeah, I don't think Venom would have had that much of a narrative impact on it. It would, again, I think the Venom that is with Tom Hardy is they're gonna do something with it. They're gonna do something big with it. They're gonna do something big with that Venom. Venom's making its own franchise. It's making a lot of money.
Yeah, so it's making a ton of money.
So I think they're gonna do something huge when it comes to Venom and Spider-Man.
I hope so, man. Like I really do. I don't want them not to do Spider-Man, but so far they're making it confusing as fuck, and I just really want them to land the plane.
Mm-hmm. Oh, they will. I think, like I said, I'm with the exception of when it comes to the MCU in general, the only movie. Well, there's two. The only two movies that I'm like, if it's on, I guess I'll watch it. The big one, though, that I'm just like, my buddies want me to do reviews about the Eternals, and I'm like, I'd have to watch that movie again, and I really don't want to.
I still haven't seen it.
And again, you ready for the Eternals review by John Agricola. Here it is. It is a 2-hour and 40-minute film.
240?
I forget how long. It feels that long. I mean, it feels like you're sitting in a theater forever watching this movie. And it is the longest get the band back together movie on God's green earth. And that's the other thing. It's just like, we're going to cut back to this time period. All right, cool. We know nothing happens because we still have all of our fucking Eternals. So you guys are showing us. They're showing us these, and it's beautiful. The movie is gorgeous. It's like the characters are fine, but it's like, are we going to, you guys going to fight? Or do anything. I mean, you're fighting off these, like, when the villains show up, you guys handle them incredibly easily, and we know the big threat because you guys have found out what the big threat is, and it's coming, and you guys are still getting the band together trying to stop it. Like, I'm like, oh my god, it takes forever for this movie to like you want to talk, there's like a slow burn and then there's the fucking Eternals. And so now here I am talking about the Eternals and like do I think it's a bad movie? Fuck no, but I wish I would have known.
I don't remember why we're talking about the Eternals.
Dude, because we're getting into the movies that I want to go back and watch again.
Okay.
And there's only two movies that I did not want to rewatch. One of them is the Eternals because it's not that I didn't like it, but it's the same way. Like if you watch The Godfather, do you really want to watch The Godfather the next day too? That's a bad example because The Godfather is fucking great. So, but anyway, there's a lot of great movies out there that are just slow or they're like a lot to do, like Django Unchained. That is an awesome movie. Can you watch Django Unchained every day? Probably not. There's a fucking shit that happens in that movie. But the Eternals is the exact opposite. It was like, I don't want to watch that again. I don't want to clear that much time off my block to make sure I can watch that movie again. The other movie that I do not want to rewatch is Captain Marvel, because Superman needs his kryptonite. And whenever you make any superhero the all-powerful and she doesn't have to worry about anything, it makes for an incredibly boring movie. There. Spider-Man is not that, though. Spider-Man Far From Home gets a 10 out of 10 for me. Now, before I see it again, it'll stay 8 out of 10. But it's an amazing movie. When I left the theater, though, No Way Home was a 10 out of 10. And then I've like had to reel it back. I've been listening to what a lot of other people have said about it. It's like, yeah, you make some points, and it's knocked it down a peg or two. But again, it's like, no, I want it. But at the same time, I want to go rewatch it.
I keep like every day, I'm like, all right, I'm going to go back today. Like I was going to go see it yesterday for a refresher to do the show. And it was like 11 o'clock. Both IMAX showings were like, a lot of it was sold out, but you still had a few decent seats. I took a nap. I woke up at like 2:15. Both showings were sold out of IMAX. Obviously there was a bunch of digitals, but like, fuck that. I'm going to see it in IMAX. Even today, I'm like, I might want to go see it after we get done recording. Yeah. Fuck knows. I want to see this movie as much as possible because, again, like a 2.5 hour movie and it just goes by in a snap, a Thanos snap, if you will.
Oh.
Let's talk about this last MJ scene with Peter and MJ.
Like in the cafe?
In the little like sweet shop. How fucking mature for, because he was ready. He was ready to fill his promise. And he sees the wound, even though it's just a Band-Aid.
Yeah.
He sees that he hurt her. And he's like, I can't do that to her again. What if it's worse? And with a look, there's so much good acting in this fucking movie.
Here we go.
There's so much good acting in this movie. So much is said with just like looks and oh my God. But he decides to leave her be. And then again, that last shot of her of just, you know, just fucking like scratching her head a little bit. You know, what do you take away from that scene?
What do you mean? What do I take away from it? It sucks. It sucks. I mean, it's amazing, but it sucks. As the viewer, it sucks. It's like, oh my God, you're right. How hard would it be to be like, oh, and by the way,
I'm Spider-Man,
and you love me.
I did kind of half expect him to go up to Ned and like try to befriend him again.
Yeah,
because he sees that he's sitting by himself, and I don't know. He could have. Any number of things he could have interacted, but I think it's the same idea of I don't want to put my friends in danger anymore, even though they're not my friends. I'm still their friend.
Yeah.
You know? Aww.
Billy, you got to stop doing this, all right? I get to the high points, and then you hit me with fucking Aunt May dying, and you hit me with like, goodbye, Spider-Man. I don't want to do that anymore, Billy.
Okay, what about when Garfield goes, I always wanted brothers.
That was great. That's great, Billy. That's great. Can we talk about, we already talked about, you're amazing.
The youth pastor thing?
The youth pastor thing. Yes, let's talk about youth pastor.
Dude, I was so scared they weren't going to put Toby in the suit or that he didn't want to be in the suit.
Really?
Because he shows up in his street clothes, man.
Yeah.
And immediately, because, you know, I'm the cynic in me. This isn't our first time around the fucking block, man. We've been getting hit with nostalgia bombs lately that don't quite do it. But I was really scared. But then just a couple scenes later, they do us right. And he's like, are you going to web sling like that? And he's just like, bitch.
Yeah. Go, Toby. What a wonderful movie this was.
Could you do that? Like, could you, going back to the MJ scene, unless not could you see the fucking movie again? Of course you could. But do you think you could do that? Like, if you were Peter, even if you were John, like, let's say, you know, you are Spider-Man and Diane forgot you're Spider-Man, forgot you. Could you leave her be, or would you have to be selfish and be like, nah, fuck that. I want to be happy with.
Yeah, I can leave her be.
You think you could?
Oh, yeah.
You heard it here first, Dan. He doesn't care about you.
I didn't say that. I could leave you be if it meant to keep you safe, baby girl. I know you listening and you watching and everything. Just know that I'm thinking about you right now. Take on this.
All right, we're going to start wrapping up here. This has been a really awesome show. I know John probably wasn't prepared for the enormity of it, but...
Oh, no, I was not. I would have watched Amazing Spider-Man 2.
Oh. Well,
if I would have known about the enormity.
I mean, I did advertise.
You said Spidey. Hey, you want to do a Spidey round table? I was like, yeah, I can do a Spidey. And then my brain was like, oh, we're going to do a No Way Home.
Well, yeah, the whole point was No Way Home, but...
And then...
The posts literally said, Toby to Tom. I don't want to hear it. But just kind of looking at the last of my notes, if there's anything else we want to talk about. Are you disappointed that it was a trailer as the last end credit stinger instead of like an actual scene?
No, because that's what Cap gave us. The first Captain America, the first Avenger, gave us the Avengers trailer as its end credit scene. And so I will never, ever, 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 ever be upset with anybody who gives me a fresh trailer at the end of their movie.
That's fair. Are you excited for the new Strange? I am.
Dude, again, unless its name is Eternals or Cap Marvel, I'm fucking ready for it. You know, and actually, I would be more excited for if Captain Marvel 2 was coming out tomorrow, I'd go see it, because I think, you know, they're going to realize it's like, all right, cool. We're going to put Carol Danvers in her place and realize that, yeah, she's got all this badass power, but there's some shit that she can't handle, which is the entire, again, here we are talking about this fucking movie, which is the entire flaw that I had with Captain Marvel is that she was unstoppable. There is nothing anyone can do to dissuade her from doing anything.
Well, we'll start wrapping up with our webs here. Is there anything else, John, you want to touch on with No Way Home? I mean, there's little things we could change about the story that you could pick. Yep. Even if you love something, you can pick it apart a little bit. But I say this a lot with a lot of things I'm excited about. Of like, I can't believe how much I enjoyed it, but this movie's special.
Yeah,
like it really, really is. It's more than just a cash grab of nostalgia to me, you know. Like, yes, nostalgia grabs are a big thing right now, but I think this is so much more than that. Again, going back to Amy Pascal and Kevin Feige,
yeah,
they've been wanting to tell these stories for a while, and it's not only for them but for Tobey Maguire and for Andrew Garfield, like you alluded to, getting to put the bow on their franchises and really show off what their characters could have been.
Yeah.
You know, especially giving glimpses into like Andrew Garfield's universe of how he says like, at a certain point, I stopped pulling my punches.
Yeah.
Like that's heartbreaking. Like you want to know more.
Yeah.
You want to know more about what happened to this guy, man. And Toby is obviously the grizzled vet, like I said, and you want to know what happened to him too. It's the old adage of less is more, and this movie makes you wanting more, for sure. What are your lasting thoughts of No Way Home?
Of No Way Home as a film or a movie is amazing. I got excited for it when I saw the teaser trailer. I was excited for it when they dropped the trailer.
Yeah,
I mean, it's just this movie, like, very rarely does a movie live up to your expectations. And this one did. And again, about the
exceeded.
So, again, to Billy's point, yeah, you can nitpick it. Yes, me and you watched that. We looked at it with a microscope. We could be like, Spider-Man wouldn't do that. You know what I'm saying? We could probably figure out a whole bunch of different little things. We could bitch about this movie, but we won't, because we understand. We go in, and I got exactly what I wanted, what I paid for. It's like,
totally.
Paid my money, got exactly. Now, Billy, as an existential thing, check this out. What has this movie done in a pandemic era to the movie business?
Bro, it's breaking all kinds of records, not just pandemic records. It's
second highest weekend of all time.
I think the Monday or the Friday alone was $250 million.
The grand total for the weekend, if I'm not mistaken, I saw it on.
I've been wondering what it is too.
$260 million. It is the second highest opening weekend of all movies ever. The only thing that beats it right now is Endgame. That is the only movie above.
I think it's going to beat Endgame
in total.
No
way. No way. You're not going to get to $3 billion. There is, because what is it? I think Endgame's sitting at 2.8. Is its current total?
I don't remember, honestly.
Yeah, Endgame's sitting at like $2.8 billion.
All I'm saying is I think this movie is better than Endgame in many, many ways. Yeah, oh. I think.
All right. All right.
The pace of it, dude.
And then we just opened up the debate aspect, and here we go for another 3 hours about How bad Billy from Philly is incorrect.
Nah, come on. Like, Endgame's 3 hours. This is 2.5. You know, I understand there's that difference, but it, I feel like it's paced a lot better. Yeah, there were cheers in Endgame, but it, it wasn't like this. It, Endgame was a great experience, but it was nothing like No Way Home. I think, I don't know, you're right. It probably won't beat Endgame because Endgame was an event that everyone and their mother knew about.
Yeah.
And this is solely for the fans for the most part.
Yeah.
But dude, I personally enjoy it way more than Endgame.
I know after I watch this movie, not necessarily in the theater. I know after I watch Spider-Man, No Way Home, about half a dozen more times when it comes in on streaming services, and I watch it a lot, and I will. If I just feel in a few months, like 6 months from now, Billy, you're gonna look at me and be like, John, you have a choice to watch one movie, Endgame or No Way Home. Which one's it gonna be? I'm like, Endgame. Ask me like right now. It's because again, Endgame for me has that nostalgia effect of you dump all your action figures out on the floor and you don't have enough hands to run your Avengers into these aliens. Endgame gladly picks up your action figures for you and just throws them together right there at the end. And it's fucking great. Anyway, so that if you ask me,
speaking of action figures,
I'm telling you, speaking of action figures, it's fucking beautiful. They're all wonderful. Doc Ock is top heavy. And I think Carnage is just a dumbass. But anyway, so yeah, you're talking about like, now is that a knock on, you know, No Way Home? It's like, sorry, this one guy over here doesn't like you as much as Endgame. I don't think so. I don't think that's a knock on anything, man. So, to me,
I'll put it in Spidey terms.
Oh.
It's MJ Gwen Stacy. It's just one slice of wonderful or the other.
Yeah.
It's just a matter of preference. Oh. You know, I think Spider-Man is the funner, more poignant film in total.
All right.
Whereas Endgame has a lot of, not even a lot. They have like a few just heavy hitting moments for the entire universe.
Yeah, that's what I say.
That's the big difference.
It's the big payoff for 12 years of work. Yeah. That's what Endgame is.
Absolutely. I 100% agree. So, all right, man, this has been a ton of fun. I want to thank my guest, John Agricola, again. You can follow him at That Guy John A. You're still streaming?
I on occasion.
On occasion?
Yeah, it's all right. I'm not really out there in the social media world anymore, but I come in here to talk to Billy about movies. Hopefully I can do this again, not wait 2 years.
Yeah, it's been a hot minute. Unfortunately, you live across the way, and it's a chore to get together in the same room like this. But yeah, man, you're one of my favorite panelists for sure.
He just says that because I'm here.
He's not wrong.
Well, first off, I know I am. You told me that. Before you told me I'm your favorite panelist. I'm just playing.
But, all right, folks. Thank you for joining us on another episode of the Nerd Herd. Please like, follow, share, subscribe, comment. Do all that stuff to help make our roar louder. And remember, stay sticky.
Oh, yeah. Dig on this.